That's me.
Yeah. Oh my god, that's good audio, dude.
That gain, or is that gain?
The better. There
we go. Did you hear him gargling?
Yeah. Do it again.
Gargle?
No.
Please. Yeah. See.
Scotch, scotch, scotch.
Scotchy, scotch, scotch.
Here it goes down in my belly.
Excess picked up bourbon.
Walking it off. Walking it off.
I'm not even upset. I'm impressed. The entire wheel of cheese?
That was
I'm not even upset.
That was intense.
What
was
a good
solid pour.
Ron Burgundy.
That
you
was
ate
a solid
an entire
pour whiskey.
What?
You're going to be hammered.
Wheel?
You ate an entire cheese. I'm not even mad. I'm impressed. You know I don't speak Spanish. English, please. Yeah.
Test.
Oh, no, you're fine. I wasn't giving you. You drink all the whiskey you
no,
want.
No, I'm just making sure that you were good.
No, you're fine.
I just care about you.
I was like, damn, that's 2/3 of a cup of coffee worth of whiskey.
Slow down, hippie.
Hey, was there a problem with the audio from Big Three?
Of course.
Yeah, the
Big Three.
When we did the radio interviews, it
not too bad.
Yeah,
not too bad.
No, did you have?
It's not what
well,
I
there was a couple. Yeah.
Yeah, I would.
We had because the power was going off and on occasionally. It screwed things up.
We're not going to Big Three again.
You're not?
Yeah, it's a lot of money. It's not always.
I'm sad to hear that.
Yeah, it's a lot of money, and it's not always the most fun.
Like for a booth. What's a booth cost of these things?
Okay, so Big Three, I don't know, about 10 grand.
Yeah.
SHOT Show, about $250,000.
Costs $250,000 for
would
a booth?
You, all in, when you buy the booth.
Well, you got to pay for the booth, you got to pay for electricity, you got to pay for the carpeting and pad, you got to pay for people to go there.
That's,
you got to feed
well,
them,
I see
hotel
you're
them,
you're saying, right.
Travel them.
I knew a company that just spent $500,000 on the physical booth.
On the
yeah,
booth.
I know, listen.
Like, just the,
I know.
Yeah,
we hear yours. Hold on.
Test. Right. Talking. Matt Reynolds, closer. Yeah, right here, better. Okay, I'll
back,
close.
You're good. Back.
Okay.
Just
right
saying.
Here, test. Scotchy. Thanks for having me.
Hey, this is Marshall. This is Dude Gun Radio.
Hear that fucking voice?
Say it again.
Hear that fucking voice?
Test, mic one. Test.
I think you do this because you like electronic shit, dude.
I got this new piece right here.
Yeah.
You gotta use it.
You get a ham radio when you're 11.
You jacked everything up. All right. Good. Y'all ready?
Y'all ready for this?
I need to find out whatever's wrong.
Number one. Careful.
Can you guys snap a picture of us doing this?
We're Facebook Live, right?
Yeah. Are we live right now, Jared?
Yeah, but he can't post that to his page.
Yeah, that's true. We got to tag everybody. Tag you, tag me.
No,
swears. Don't be saying any swears.
Hey,
are you
look, like you look like you're.
No, working. You can swear. Well, on your Facebook.
Hey, smile
on,
smile for the camera.
Well, it's live.
Smile for the camera.
Wait a second, that's a video. All right, you ready?
Yep.
In 3, 2, 1 more. 3, 2.
Man, I feel sorry for everybody has to sit there and be quiet while we don't do anything.
That's
test. All right, here we go.
Hey, that's a ticket that they bought.
Give me about
Cooper.
5 seconds of silence.
Josh Blanche. Oop.
I can't.
If you want 5 seconds of silence, ask Ben for 10.
All right, guys. Ooh, that's way too much gain. Holy shit. Alright guys, no,
sorry.
You're hearing that gain?
What is gain?
I'm good, but
gain.
It might be
super loud.
It's hot vector.
You like
sizzle.
Grobbly?
No, not at all.
Testing. 1, 2, 1, 2.
Yeah,
test.
This sounds great.
It sounds good.
Sound good coming through there?
This ain't Mozart. Let's go. Right.
In my headphones, it sounds good.
Mm-hmm. Sound good in yours too?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's good. Right.
It's probably just mine. I got fucked up ears. Alright, lead heads. Welcome back to not only the new episode of Talking Lead, but the new year itself, 2017. Welcome to the Nordic Opponents Talking Lead Podcast, episode 183, ladies and gentlemen.
No way. Is that true?
That's true. We are 183. And we are at none other than Camden, Tennessee, NES Tactical Response. And we're here for a special class held by this gentleman right here, Mr. Matt Reynolds.
Yep.
And we're joined by another man, Mr. Paul Markham. So
that's me.
Preacher Paul. And Ben Mookie. What's up, buddy?
Hey, how are you? Good. Hi, day. Everybody.
In case people don't know, Ben, he's with Spikes.
Spikes Tactical.
Spikes Tactical.
Yeah.
Plug. I made it 10 seconds.
Maker of the Crusader.
Crusader rifle. Available at gun stores everywhere. Lifetime warranty. Just contact me.
Just ask him. He'll tell you about it. So, guys, we're here to get strong.
Yeah.
In the next couple of days. This is day one. We just wrapped up day one. Had a nice dinner over at Smart's, I think it was called.
Smarter's, the best restaurant in Camden, Tennessee, by my estimation. Been eating here 8, 9, 10 years.
And that's the best one so far?
Absolutely.
It was pretty good.
It was pretty good.
That nice steak.
That would have been a decent meal in any town.
Yeah, they need a liquor license.
Yeah.
With some beer.
Yes.
Some scotch.
But we're taking care of that here with a nice bottle of Longhaired Jim.
And what's interesting about this bottle is that it's commemorating the 20th anniversary of XS Big Dot Sights.
It's a big dot whiskey.
You know, they're a great company, also out of Texas, right?
Yeah, Fort Worth.
Yep.
Yeah, they bought a barrel. Big Dot did and sent that to Jaeger.
So, Matt, you are new to our audience.
Yep.
Why don't you tell our audience, the Leadheads, a little bit about Matt Reynolds.
Sure.
And what you're doing here with the... Fighting Strong.
Sure.
Class.
Fight Strong. Yeah.
Fight Strong?
Thanks for having me. Yeah, either one's fine. Yeah, so...
They both work, right?
They both work. Mm-hmm. Yeah, man, I got into to strength training in the late 90s. I was a pretty average athlete in high school and very competitive, but not good enough to play anything in college, unfortunately.
So, you and me both.
Yeah, so I needed an outlet for that. So I discovered weightlifting and strength training in high school. Junior, senior year of high school was actually fairly average at that as well, probably a little better than I was at basketball and baseball and the sports I played. So I discovered in 1999 a sport called powerlifting, which is a sport that rewards eating and lifting, which is different.
Not necessarily healthy eating. But
no. Yeah. I actually wrote an article a couple years ago called Eating Through the Sticking Points, which was when I graduated high school, I weighed 155 pounds. When I got married in 2000, I weighed 170.
Wow.
I'm 285-ish.
Yeah, you're a big boy now.
It was on purpose, and I'm actually coming back down. So yeah, I discovered the sport of powerlifting, which rewarded eating and lifting and getting strong. And so I poured myself into that sport, started competing, did my first competition by the year 2000 or 2001. I totaled a lead, or the kind of the top level certification of powerlifting. By 2003, started to pursue strongman, like you've seen the World's Strongest Man, in
right.
2005.
Now, to achieve the elite level in that sport, I mean,
sure.
That's...
Sure. Yeah, it's pretty good numbers. I at that time, I think the
pretty
first time
elite,
I...
Pretty elite, just like it says.
Yeah, there's weight classes there. I competed in the 242 weight class. And it's a weird number because it's kilos. Or it's, I think it's 110 kilo class. Mm-hmm. And I think that's somewhere...
Damn metrics.
Yeah, I know, the Europeans. French use that. They sit down to pee, man. I mean, you stand up to pee, so you use imperial system.
That's there you go.
That's right.
Yeah.
Anyway, so 242 class. Elite was somewhere in the ballpark. I had a 750 squat, a 565 bench press.
Damn.
And
that's kilos too.
No, it's not kilos. Maybe a 705 deadlift somewhere there. So that got me to elite, and I loved it. It was fun, but. The only thing about powerlifting was it was the same three lifts every single time I competed. And so at some point I wanted a little variation. So in 2005 I turned my attention to strongman, like you see.
Strongman,
yeah. World's Strongest Man on TV. And you know, your listeners are probably, they probably know Bill Kazmaier and seen some of that old stuff on ESPN running at Christmas time.
Mm-hmm.
So did that, and that was
Franco Colombo.
Franco
carrying the giant boulders. You know,
you remember the one
pulling tractors?
You remember the one where he had the refrigerator on his back?
Broke his leg. Broke and snapped his knee.
His knee.
You're talking about Franco Colombo?
Yeah.
The
little short guy like your son.
Arnold's friend.
Yo,
yeah.
He's a chiropractor.
Yeah.
You know, Arnold Schwarzenegger is the most loyal friend. That dude barely passed the test to become a chiropractor. He's like, renowned for barely having passed. He made him in charge of board certification for the state of California.
No, that's great.
Motherfucker!
Oh, you're going to hell for that one.
Pay to have friends, right?
No shit, dude. Yeah. You know he's in Terminator, the original?
Franco.
You know, there's a flashback scene when the Terminators bust in, the dogs go,
yeah,
and he comes in, and there's a dude with a red eye. That's Franco Colombo.
Yeah.
Again, hooking him up.
Yeah, that's right. I forget.
Several of them on top.
The money together in real estate, commercial real estate.
Yes.
So they basically, they started buying apartment buildings.
That is, if he's ever in a white Bronco, Franco Colombo's driving.
Yeah, sure. Or vice versa.
Or vice versa.
Yeah. No, I agree. Yeah, so I got into strongman, and actually was probably the best sport I ever was a part of. I was naturally relatively good at that, and actually won my pro card in strongman of the year 2006. So in just a year of competing in that, won my pro card. And I think at the time there were two new pros in the U.S. per year, and so I actually won my pro card with Brian Shaw that year, who is the current reigning world strongest man, good buddy of mine. He is, to
good
put
company.
Things into perspective, he's 6'8 or 6'9 and 440
Dang.
Pounds. He's the largest human being you've ever seen.
Holy crap.
So anyway, I did strongman, competing in that. That was a blast. And so, and had started to coach some, you know, I was married and had my first kid in 2005. And opened a gym in 2008 with really no delusions of grandeur. I just didn't think a hardcore powerlifting strongman gym could make it. But was also a teacher, was a public school teacher, taught industrial technology. And
admirable.
Yeah, yeah. It was fun. Actually, liked the kids and the politics and stuff was not as good. So so I really started pushing on the gym and trying to get the gym to grow. And so by 2013, we had become the largest strength gym in the country in Springfield, Missouri. I'm from Springfield, Missouri. So it's a town of about just under 200,000 people and about a million in the metro, just under a million in the metro. It was a good-sized town.
Good size, yeah.
It's the right-sized town for what we did. So, you know, if you think about, there were no competitors for what we did in that town. The gym was in a downtown retail hub, one of these kind of gentrified downtowns. We bought 15,000 square foot location and grown it. And we were able to break into the market of business professionals and soccer moms. And so we trained business professionals and soccer moms, like powerlifters and strongmen.
That's awesome.
Yeah, it was pretty cool. And so the building was nice. It was a, you know, new, super nice building, super clean, great service. And so I got into that, and my coaching kind of prowess continued to grow because of the accolades we received from being one of the largest gyms in the country. So sold that gym in December of last year and started full-time online coaching. So I've been doing online coaching since the late 90s, started doing that, and that grew. So we just traded out Mookie for Jaeger.
Yeah. Somebody said, just gave us either for Jaeger.
Treated out one celebrity for another.
I don't know what to do with my hands.
it's okay, it's radio. You can do anything.
No, we're on Facebook Live.
Actually, we're live right
there. We're live on Facebook here, too. Say hey to Student of the Gun crowd. Word.
You see it?
Yep.
So started
so sold that.
What am I drinking?
Sold that, and I started the Big Dot Whiskey, or the San Pellegrino.
Long hair.
From Mookie. So bubbly water. So yeah, I sold that in the December of last year, and at the same time, while all the business stuff was going on, I started to grow a seminar business. So I did seminars since early 2010 with Mark Ripito, mm-hmm. and Starting Strength, and that's where I met Jaeger. Probably when did we meet? 2012-ish, somewhere in there. Jaeger came and attended a seminar, just a paying customer in one of our seminars. Learned he had just gone through people that are familiar with him. He had gone through a massive weight loss and it was in good shape, but wasn't strong. And was looking to get strong.
So I was really strong, just by
you
the way.
You were not really strong.
So, unnaturally strong. Right?
So for your listeners that don't know Starting Strength and Mark Ripito, Mark Ripito is pretty much in the fitness industry known as the maybe the greatest strength coach of all time, and certainly the most well-known strength coach alive today. He wrote a book called Starting Strength, which was really a massive kind of seminal context on barbell training. And so Jaeger takes my hey, I don't know what I'm doing, which is great. It's a blank slate. Comes in and says, hey, you can teach me. And I have him on the platform for the power clean, which is a tough
Jaeger lift. Willing to learn something?
He's willing to learn. He's a good dude.
He told me I was physically retarded.
Hashtag allegedly. And so for people in the fitness industry, Mark Ripito is extremely well known. And so Jaeger comes up to me and he says, after I get down on the platform with him, he says, hey, do you shoot? do I shoot what? Guns? And he said, yeah.
Do I said, shoot up? What are you accusing me of, man? Come
so
on.
So I said, yeah, I mean, not. I wasn't raised around guns, but I just bought my first gun. And he said, he tells the story, he says, what gun did you buy? And of course, he's thinking in his head, like, oh my God, what's he
going to say?
What's he going to say, right? And so I said, well, I bought a Glock 19. He's like, oh my God, great, you know, great gun. It's a great starter gun.
He's like, what? Well,
buddies. Oh, man.
I don't have to diss this guy.
We're going to be friends now.
And then he says, well, I just want you to know that I'm the Mark Ripito of shooting. I'm the Mark Ripito of firearms. And I said, what an arrogant piece of shit. And he handed me a business card that said MFCEO. You know, we teach good people.
Reinforcing your statement even more now, right?
I was like, who is this guy? So he says, do you have a holster and a belt? And I said, no, I keep it in one of those little $4 bags from Bass Pro Shops in the side of my car. And I'll send you a holster. So, people promise this kind of stuff all the time with these seminars. Yeah, I'm never going to hear from him again. I get home, fly home from Atlanta, and I've got an email, and it says, hey, this is James Jager. Thanks so much for class. It was awesome. I learned so much. You know, thank you for being cool and working with me and being patient. Watch this video on holsters, and I'll send you, you pick whatever holster you want, I'll send you a holster. And so I think, who would make a video on holster? That sounds like an incredibly boring thing. And so I pull it up, and there's like 400,000 views on this video on. I'm like, God damn, this guy is the Mark. Who's this guy? How could you make a video that boring?
You have your smartphone.
I know. Yeah. That many people watch a boring video. So we struck up a friendship, started working with him and coming down here. And so I took training from him. I've taken the way of the pistol and I've done a bunch of training with him on the firearm side, the fight side, the medical stuff. And he's done a bunch of my stuff. He started to send Heather, his daughter, to me, and we did. She's done some of our seminars, and,
right.
And so we struck a friendship. So I think this is the fifth Fight Strong, or fourth or fifth Fight Strong that we've done. So we started to put together this idea. You know, for me, I realized several years ago that for me to be harder to kill, I really had the physical aspect of that filled. I was strong. I was in great shape. But you do
make a big target.
But I make a big target. And I didn't know what I needed to know about your world. And so I started to get training from Jager. But he realized the same thing, especially for his guys and for his audience. And so, he preaches mindset first and certainly, you know, gear last. And that struck a chord with me. And so we started to say, look, there are a lot of people out there that spend a lot of money on gear and even may spend a lot of time training this world, mm-hmm. And then outside of that are really sedentary kind of fat slobs,
right.
and they're not hard to kill, and they refuse to admit that this is the weak link in their chain. And so we started in Fight Strong, which is just a very basic class on how to get strong, how to get in shape, how to eat, how to program, so that you can be harder to kill.
Right.
And it's been very successful.
If I could jump in there, basically, when I went to the starting strength class, I was looking for Fight Strong, meaning that I was looking for like a user level, class on how to do it. And Fight Strong is like a collegiate physics anatomy class.
Starting strength.
It was just too much, and so this class was for the we came up with it for the caveman, and. You know, I tell people about shooting. Like, shooting is simple. It's not easy. Well, the same thing could be said about strength. It's not.
Absolutely.
It's simple getting strong.
Yep.
It's just not easy.
Yeah, and doing it right.
Sure.
You know, that's the thing that I discovered. You know, our first day here is that for, you know, the past 35 years, I've been doing it wrong.
Sure.
Yeah. So, and a minute ago, I was further away from the microphone. They moved the microphone closer to me. And I do that on my YouTube videos to make people mad. I have the sound variances on there, so they have to turn it up. I just really do it.
Well, our lead heads are used to me jacking up the audio anyway. So.
Hey, can I interrupt real quick?
Absolutely.
Well, oh!
Mookie brings gifts.
So check this out. Tactical response attracts a lot of very interesting people. Today in our class, we had an optometrist, a pharmacist, a chemical engineer. But I just found a motherfucker who works for Carl's, that chocolate company.
Russell Stover,
man. God bless you. I was walking around while you guys were talking. Sure. I said, hey, does anyone have any M&Ms? I'm fiending. He goes, I work for Russell fucking Stover. He went to his car and brought out. I got like 900 chocolates in front of me.
Tell us about your Russell Stover. Russell fucking Stover.
Russell Stover is an American-owned company. All of our chocolates make in the United States.
This works perfect with our workout, right?
Holy crap. We burned calories today, so we earned it.
We didn't get into the nutrition part yet, so this doesn't count.
With Valentine's coming up, we're 68% of the box heart chocolate in America.
Okay, enough about Russell Stover. What's your name?
Scott Bentley.
Scott Bentley, and you're here for the
fighting rifle.
The fighting rifle.
Crushing your head.
Which that's not what we're talking about today, but we will talk about that soon.
Roger that.
So how you like the fighting rifle, real quick?
It is awesome.
Yeah?
Learned a lot.
One thing you learned today.
I'm sorry, sir?
One thing you learned today.
One thing I learned today is when you're coming up on target and your finger is off the trigger, touch, then squeeze, instead of just trying to pull that thing straight back, because you got the word go. You know, you don't necessarily shoot at that word.
Yeah.
Get everything
lined up.
You can
see his head shaking right now.
Oh, he's into it, man. I learned this today.
Yeah. I mean, it just makes
Facebook Live can see it.
For me, all this stuff makes me a better person, makes me a better father, a better provider for my family.
Right on, man. So, yeah. Right on.
Is there a reason that's why I love this place?
Thank you for the chocolate.
Oh, no problem, man. I came here for Fighting Pistol in October and told people that. They're like, why don't you? I was like, I didn't think a bunch of dudes wanted chocolate. Hey, apparently,
chocolate's always a hit, man.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, this one.
Cool, thanks. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you, man.
All right.
Hey, you're awesome. Thank you.
All right, so let's get back to Fight Strong.
Let's do. Who has less candy in their mouth right now?
I don't know.
Mookie has less
candy. I have less, so I'll talk. That whole thing bothers me. Then we'll get to Mookie. So you and Jaeger got together. You guys met a few years ago. Mm-hmm. You've done five of these courses. Just give us a high level, because we want people to actually go and sign up for these courses. But give us a high level what the course encompasses. Yeah.
So I want to give you the biggest bang for your buck, so that you can accomplish the most you can possibly accomplish in the shortest amount of time. So we focus on how to get strong using the basic barbell lifts like the squat, the deadlift, the bench press, and the press. We look at the biggest lifts with the most compound, biggest compound movements, the ones that make you the strongest, the fastest. We teach you how to do those exactly right. I'm a huge form Nazi. And so we walk through exactly how to do this correct. It's not, hey, do the squat. It's there are an infinite number of ways you can squat, and I'm going to teach you exactly how to do the squat.
Different variations on the squat.
That's exactly right. Yeah. So that
when you do one, this is how you.
This is the right way to do a squat.
Yeah. Which I've been doing wrong for 35 years.
Yeah, this is the way to take.
Guilty.
This is the way to take the pressure off your knees. Here's the problem. We see people all the time, even in this kind of tactical world, who really are probably mentally tough guys. But for whatever reason, in the physical world, they go, oh, I can't do this because this. I can't squat, or I can't do this because I've got bad knees, or I can't squat or deadlift because I've got a bad back. And so we show you, like, actually you can do those things. And if you have a bad back, doing nothing on your back, Mookie, it's so loud with the Russell Stover candy.
Mookie's turning into that candy.
It's just like, it's like a rabid dog on that thing.
Hey, what's a Roman nougat?
I think it's something that they have in their bathrooms.
In the bathhouses.
Yeah.
So, we go over these issues to say, look, if you have a bad back and you do nothing on it, it's going to become more vulnerable and more vulnerable to injury. And if we teach you how to do it right and get strong that way, then we're going to make your back strong and less vulnerable to injury. So, we've worked with people who have all sorts of injuries. We've worked with people who have knee replacements and hip replacements and disc fusions in their back and herniated disc and just, all sorts of stuff. I've got a guy with polio that has used one arm, and these guys don't make excuses. We had Nate today who did it with an ileostomy bag.
I like the story you told us about the lady.
Yeah, I've got one of my favorite clients is an 82-year-old.
This is amazing.
She plays a pipe organ for her church, like one of those million-dollar pipe organs. She's literally a church organist at a big Methodist church, and she had never stepped in a gym in her life. I'd actually trained her son. He had come in to visit her for Christmas. She lives in my town. He had come in from Colorado to visit her for Christmas several times and gotten coaching from me and wanted me to work with her. And she had never been in a gym. She had never done anything physical in her life. She was a widow. She had lost her husband 7 or 8 years ago. He was a psychiatrist, and so she lived in a big house. She hadn't been upstairs in a couple of years. She was having trouble getting in and out of her car.
Mm-hmm.
All of her kids lived in the Pacific Northwest, and so she was really on a fast track to a nursing home.
Mm-hmm.
And so we finally we got together, and I went over to her house the first time. She'd never been in a gym in her life.
Her son tell you about it?
Yeah, so he kind of put us together, and we emailed back and forth, and she was really sweet. And
that was smart of him to do that.
He was, yeah. And I said, her name is Sybil, she's great. Hey, Sybil. And we cursed too much on this.
So yeah.
I went to her house, and she made me coffee and biscotti, really dipping biscotti in the coffee.
Nice.
And I taught her how to squat to her dining room chair all by herself. And this lady is 82 years old. She's had double hip replacements.
Oh my gosh.
One knee replacement. All of her discs in her back have been fused together. That's the fire alarm.
Oh, fire.
It's good. Everything's good.
Must be moved.
Relax. Yeah, you're setting off fire alarm.
She's had an inch cut off of one of her Achilles tendons. And she's a disaster, you know. And she squats and deadlifts and bench presses and presses. And she's 82 years old. And
your excuse?
Yeah, so week before last, she deadlifted 140 pounds for a set of five at 82.
Oh, my God.
What
does this lady weigh?
Oh, not very much. I mean, she's a small, little, frail old lady. That's what she is, right? So, I've certainly never asked her what she weighs. I don't know. She's a normal size, totally. She's not overweight.
She's like 5'4".
Yeah, 5'4", you know, and she's got a kyphotic curve. You know, she's got that kind of hunchback thing going, 82 years old. And she's great, and so she's been incredible. She just sticks with the program and does this stuff. Works whether you're 13 years old or 82.
It's not too late.
No, it's not too late. She started this a month before her 80th birthday. So when she was 79 the first time. That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And here, what's amazing is she goes upstairs all the time now. She has guests over to her house and keeps them upstairs, cleans the upstairs. She told me the other day she got under her bed and got boxes out she hadn't had out in 6 or 7 years.
Right.
She got in her. She has a big Whirlpool bathtub in her bathroom. We got in that, laid in. She's 82 years old. And, you know, she gets in and out of her car. She actually bought a sports car about 6 months ago. That's a lower little coupe that she got into because she can get into it now, right?
That's awesome.
So it's people don't realize
it.
Yeah, this stuff matters, man. It matters for us. Look, if we're preaching this mindset that we want to be harder to kill, how can you argue that stronger people are harder to kill? They're stronger people are harder to kill.
And that goes for every aspect of not just people shooting at you and you're getting in gunfights, mm-hmm. fist fights, but harder to kill just in life in general.
Yeah. You know? Yeah, you're more resilient. I mean, we were talking about this
diseases
a little bit today.
Diseases and injuries.
Car accidents, diseases. We're less vulnerable to things like wasting diseases like cancer. You get cancer and you weigh 240 pounds of muscle. What kills people in cancer is often not the cancer, but it's actually the wasting that comes from the cancer. And so if you're gaining weight and getting stronger, actually, we've got another buddy that goes to Mark Griffito's gym. He has stage 4 kidney cancer. Stage 4. The guy's going to die. He's 260 pounds, and he's probably 63, and he continues to gain weight. He comes in, he gets chemotherapy, and he drives to the gym, and he squats. And the guy squats 350 pounds for sets of five, and he's 63 years old, because he knows that if he stops, he's dead.
Yeah.
Like, it's going to get him at some point, but it can get him in 3 weeks, or it can get him in 3 or 4 or 5 or 10 years. And so he is able to say, look, I can be stronger and get more time with my kids, more time with my grandkids, more time with my wife.
More time.
Yeah, and this stuff matters. Right. And so I love it, man. I love the fact that I was able to teach kids. But, man, I am able to change an enormous amount of people's lives. And I get to see that every single day, just normal people. And so, there are a lot of trainers and coaches out there that really wire themselves towards athletes, bodybuilders, people that look great, people in their early 20s, people in their teens, college athletes. I love regular people, like general population, you know, soccer moms and soccer dads, that, you know, business professionals, grandmas, grandpas, people who have grandkids, people who want to be strong for their grandkids, people who want to walk their grandkids down the aisle at their Christmas at their wedding or at their graduation. That's the kind of people that I love to work with because I think it makes the biggest impact.
Yeah, so. Absolutely.
I don't know about any of that, but I arrived here a big skeptic. I have, at various points of my life, been strong or well-conditioned. Obviously, my time in the teams and then as a contractor. And after about 38 years of that, I had accrued a body of injuries, which resulted in spine fusion, herniated discs. Pecker wouldn't work because of the pain for a period. These are both my shoulders have been rebuilt, pec tears, all this. So I had kind of surrendered to the fact that, hey, I'm 40. I burned the candle with a blowtorch, and I've got some great memories. And as I was telling my friends, I was wrestling the garbage out to the street after Christmas, and it whooped my ass. And I decided I'm not done putting my physical will upon the world. And I wanted to start getting back into shape, and I realized I could not do the things that I used to. I am missing connective tissue. There are tendons that are now sutures. There's muscle, the belly of which has been ripped. And there are a lot of things I couldn't do. And Jaeger asked me to, if I'd come out here. And he's like talking all this shit, you know. And he's like, oh, he's so great. And I'm like, great, Jaeger, you've been lifting weights for about an hour. I get it. He's wonderful. I came here very skeptical, but I made a commitment to myself, my personal integrity. I said, I will not tell him the exercises I cannot do sure. because of my injuries. I will do them as instructed until I can't.
Sure.
Today, I lifted more weight than I have in 6 years since I had surgery. The three biggest exercises that I enjoy the most, which I have not done because of my biomechanical failures, things that my orthopedic surgeon had said I cannot do, I did with you,
yep.
without pain. Yep. I'm a believer. I'm committed to the program, and I'm going to follow to the letter the Matt Reynolds Strong program for the next 6 months, and I'm going to track my progress with 100% transparency awesome. On social media, and I want to thank you
accountability
for opening this up to my life.
Sure.
You are not a fraud. You are not full of shit. You are not internet bodybuilding dude. You are the fucking real deal.
Thanks, dude.
And you are a blessing to this community.
Thank you.
Well said.
Cheers.
Cheers. Thanks, man.
What do you say after that?
I second that, and I mean, just like you, I came into this with several injuries of my own. Kind of skeptical whether I myself would be able to go through the program and, sure. and do everything that you were going to, you know, show us to do. But with the mindset of, you know, I've been working out since I was 15, 45 now, and I had a set way of doing things that I thought was correct.
Yep.
But I came in with an open mind and willingness to listen and follow exactly what you said to the letter, just like Mookie said. And the injuries that I had, it didn't affect them
yep.
whatsoever. Sure. So I think that's probably why I have the injuries, and the reason to some of my injuries is the improper form and mechanics.
I'd like to dovetail on
Hallmark
that.
Hallmark,
yeah, well, that's exactly, you know, I injured my shoulder years and years ago when I was a cop, and so I just started babying it, like, well, if I just leave it alone and yep. you know, don't use it, it'll heal. And sure. it just took forever.
Sure.
It just took forever. And like today when we were doing certain like the press exercises,
yep.
and I realized, and actually my son said something. He had gone to a seminar. He goes, people baby things. They will get injured and then they'll specifically lay off it and they'll baby it and so forth. But then it doesn't get better. He says you don't want to re-injure yourself, but right. you have to make it get better.
Yep.
And as far as the fit, and I don't claim to be a fitness guru, but I've been doing various fitness. I was in the Marine Corps, you know,
sure.
all that. But I didn't know what to do. I knew to do it.
Sure.
But I didn't know how to do it.
Sure.
And there's a big, I believe there's a big corollary between the firearms world and the fitness world.
Sure.
Whereas people go, and I was talking to Mookie off air earlier, and he said people go to public ranges and they perform on a public shooting range as they think they're supposed to.
Sure.
Because they saw other people do yep. it, or they watched a movie, or whatever. And so they're just kind of doing what they're thinking they're supposed to be doing, but they're not really training.
Yep.
They're not really learning, and they're not really achieving any kind of goal. They're just doing.
Yep.
And people will walk into Globo Gym,
yep.
you know, the whatever fitness, and they, I think They do the same thing.
Sure.
They go over to the machines and the weights and stuff, sure, and they do what they think they're supposed to do.
Yep.
Because they saw other people do it or whatever, you know, and they're like, "Well, I picked it up, so I must be doing it right, right?" And the fact is, you know, like we at students, we're always preaching, like, "Look, you need to get training. Buying a gun doesn't make you a shooter.
Sure.
You need to go to somebody, and you can't.
Your permit does not make you.
Yeah, and you can't watch yourself and pick up on your own mistakes.
Sure.
And it's exact. I mean, with a coach, with a fitness coach. You think, oh, I'm doing it right. I'm pretty sure I'm doing it right. In the meantime, your back's all bowed, and you're like, I don't know why I'm hurting myself doing all this stuff. It's because you don't have a coach.
Sure.
And so if you've made the commitment to get the real training, to get some professional training as a shooter, you owe it to yourself to at very least take a seminar and get some coaching so that, I'm sorry,
Fading away from the microphone.
I moved when I saw
it. You're very animated.
But no, you owe it to yourself to at very least have somebody watch you, you know, and say, okay, this is what you're doing right, this is what you're doing wrong. Sure. And something else a coach will do, which is what this guy said, is he's like, you can lift more than that.
Sure.
You know, you need push beyond your comfort zone.
Sure.
Because you'll get to your comfort zone and you'll quit because that's what you've always done. You're like, okay, I'm no longer comfortable, I'm going to stop. And a coach says, no, you can lift more.
And just to give credit where credit is due, you had an assistant coach today.
Yeah, I did. So Heather Glover, who's Jaeger's daughter, she's been working with me for, gosh, probably, Heather's been working with me for a couple years.
She's my favorite daughter.
Your favorite daughter?
Jaeger's favorite daughter. Favorite
daughter. Jaeger brought her down to Springfield a few years ago, 2-3 years ago, for a squat camp I did. So I was teaching the squat, teaching how to teach the squat, how to do the squat. And she was just getting into the fitness industry, wasn't entirely sure the direction she was going to take it. And so, you know, I was skeptical of her, of whether she would stick with it. I mean, this is a tough, like Jaeger said, it's simple. It's not that difficult. It's not that complicated. Mm-hmm. But it's not easy. It's hard. And so I have a tagline I say a lot of times in the business, that's simple, hard, and effective. And this combination of simple and hard is extremely effective. And man, she has been unbelievable. So Heather's been awesome. So Heather's in Camden. Right. She runs Camden Strength here at a Tactical Response. She owns a gym here. They've got an excellent gym. I have watched her go from knowing the basic information that she needed to know and having zero self-confidence in her actual coaching ability to coaching extremely well with her day-to-day clients, the Tactical Response guys, and they got a lot of the guys in the Camden County area, but still with strangers or like if I'm watching, I'm sure she's nervous when I'm kind of looking over her shoulder.
She didn't seem nervous.
And said, today she was unbelievable. So I told Jaeger, I said, every time I've seen Heather, I've probably seen Heather coach now 8 or 10 times in the last 3 years, and every time I see her, she's 5 times better than she was the time before. And so I don't know that she is, I don't know that her skill is so much better today than it was a few months ago, but her confidence is so much better. She owned the platform today.
Absolutely.
And so she just jumped right in and coached. And we had a ton of guys, more people than I could coach in a quick enough time on the platform to be able to get everybody the reps they needed to see with one-on-one coaching. And so so I split everybody into groups, and I took one group and Heather took a group. We did a set, and then we flip-flopped. So then I would take the people that she had and vice versa, and then we flip-flop again. We just kept flip-flopping, so everybody got
we're
to
good.
I got to see every other set that everybody did, and Heather did too, and she, man, she's been awesome. So if you're in the Camden, Tennessee area, or just even in middle Tennessee, I need a coach. One, I think she's about a third of the price that I am, so I think
maybe not now.
I think for as long as she decides to keep it. I think she runs about $50 an hour, and I'm $150 an hour, and so she's an incredible deal. I mean, that's
don't hold her to that.
Yeah, no, she's not charging enough. She needs to raise her price.
Maybe more than that.
She should be more than that. But she's excellent. And what's awesome is she always offers training before and after Tactical Response classes that they run. So if you come and take a fighting pistol class, fighting rifle class, you can come in a few hours early, a day early, or get a couple hours with her. You know, on a Thursday or a Friday or on a Monday after it's over. It's well worth it. I'll tell you this. I mean, she's cut from our mold. It's cool because she is in a similar sort of way that everything I know about the kind of the firearms world, I learned from Jaeger. I mean, he's my coach. He's the guy that's worked with. So I didn't come in with any bad habits. I didn't come in and say, hey, let me show you what I know about shooting. I said, I have no clue what I'm doing. Work with me. And so I think that's refreshing for him. And it was refreshing for me to work with him the same way. But it's been the same thing with Heather. She came in and said, look, I don't know how to coach. And so everything that she does is really cut from my mold and from the starting strength mold, from our mold. She's done incredibly well. So I'm super proud of her.
And can I add to that real quick?
Sure.
Inspector Curtis Houser.
Yeah, I was here earlier this year for a fighting pistol class, and spent just a little bit of time with Heather. And I had squatted incorrectly, I might add. Squatted ever since high school with extreme knee pain. Like, I had pretty much abandoned the exercise as something that I could do. 20 minutes, she had me completely fixed. Sure. I was able to come into the class today, still maintain the form that she had reinforced with a few other tweaks from you. And man, I tell you what, hit the ground running today. And
yeah, for people that don't know you, what do you weigh?
240.
I mean, and you're 240 and not fat at all. It's 240 pounds and a big jack.
And you don't sweat much for a big jack, dude. Fat guy either.
So like, this isn't some frail beard. Here's what I'm saying is that you, in a similar way to me, people would look at us and say, these are meathead dudes, right? Somebody would look at you and go, like, this guy's not going to be real receptive to receiving coaching from a female coach. And so she's an excellent coach. So it says something about your personality, too, to say, look, like, I've done this for a long time. I've been in a gym for a long time. I was kind of beating my heads against the wall. I'm a big dude, but I wasn't necessarily functional. I had a lot of injuries. And that's part of this thing. It's one of the big pieces of Fight Strong. There's a difference between aesthetics and performance, right? Like, I try to set that up from the very beginning. Look, everybody wants to look better. And so, like, we can quit bullshitting each other and be like, look, like, we all want to look good. Like, I get it. We all want to look good naked. There's nothing wrong with that. That's fine. But if that's the ultimate goal, if that's the only goal, if the ultimate goal is to have the sweetest, most blinged out gun on the planet, not be able to use it. It's the same thing with, that's what bodybuilding is. Bodybuilding is, you've got the sweetest, most blinged out body on the planet, but there's no performance. I mean, you're almost dead when you walk on stage on bodybuilding. So I train my clients. One, we teach them how to train, not exercise, right? I talk about that today. Like, exercise is getting on a treadmill at Planet Fitness and reading Cosmo magazine and jogging on a treadmill. That's not training, that's exercise. And then we train for performance first and aesthetic second. I want to make you harder to kill because of your performance. When performance increases, aesthetics increase too. Like, you're gonna look better, right? We don't have anybody.
It just naturally happens.
It just naturally happens. But
it's a byproduct.
If you only train for aesthetics, this is not a two-way street. You can actually just look good, and in fact not be able to perform, right? So. That's an important point that we have to make. Like, we train for performance.
Now, we've all talked so far about our previous experiences. Like you said, I started lifting in high school. I was in the Marine Corps. You did it. But I want people to understand, and I'm sure you'll reinforce this, that they don't have to work out for 6 months before they come to Fight Strong. I almost called you and said, I'm not coming. I want to work out more before I come to Fight Strong. It's kind of like the...
And you knew what I was going to say, so you didn't call me.
You're like, well, I'm gonna take fighting pistol, but I need to practice some more before I come.
I'm not going to take the class. I'm not going to go to church until I clean my life up a little bit.
Yeah.
That's the exact same when Curtis called me, and he's like, hey, dude, I'm going to this class at Jaeger's this weekend. You need to go with us. And I was like,
to work out first before I go to the
class. I was like, dude, my hips hurting, my shoulders hurting.
He was very, very skeptical. He was very like, oh, dude, I don't know.
For the audience, though,
I was trying to go with an excuse.
You don't need to work out for 6 months first and then go to Fight Strong.
No, as a matter of fact, that would actually be detrimental.
Yeah, so
like you should take the class. You should show up and take the class.
Yeah.
You don't need to buy a gun and just go out and think you know how to use it. Just like working out.
I get it.
You need to get
everybody wants
first.
To show up and not suck. Again, it's ingrained in people like us. You want to show up and not suck. The problem is I would rather have a total beginner, absolute novice, blank slate and teach them the right habits from the beginning that have to come in and break bad habits. It's the exact same thing that Jaeger deals with on a daily basis in the tactical world, in the firearms world, right? People come in and they've got these bad habits. Now they got to break them of the bad habits first,
right?
And then start teaching them what
it's triple the work.
Yeah, it's triple the work. So, I have had
tons of
people. But if somebody's not a douche and they come in with an open mind and are willing to learn and correct fine. Themselves.
Absolutely.
As you say.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah, we've had
fix themselves.
Yeah, fix yourself.
Fix yourself.
We have had people who have never touched a barbell in their life at Fight Strong. And we've had people who've trained for 20 years at Fight Strong. And they both do fine. I mean, there's no way to say there's part of that is just on experience. I've done it for 23 years. I've trained tens of thousands of people from every walk of life to absolute beginner to extremely advanced, from like super fat to super skinny, eating disorders, sick, huge, competitive athlete, Olympic athlete. Like, I've trained all those people. So there's really nothing you can bring to the table that I'm going to go, oh, I've never seen this before. Mm-hmm. On the rare occasion that occurs, it's like a great day for me. I'm like, oh my God, I get to learn something today. Yeah. I get to learn how to teach this person. Absolutely. So. Yeah, it just show up. For me, my number one goal is to get people is compliance.
Right.
I want people just to start this process. I don't want them to just get the information and walk away and go like, yeah, I'll start that stuff. I want them to start today. I want them to start tomorrow as soon as they leave the class. So, I know that you're not going to be a great strength athlete tomorrow. And I know that you're probably not going to hammer your diet at 100% or 99% efficiency tomorrow. But if you can start to make the process to become harder to kill, mm-hmm. stronger, perform better.
But you got to start. That's the thing.
Yep. Yeah, it's an actionable start. Item. I mean, there's a lot of people. I'm in the business world a lot too. I've run a handful of successful businesses. There are a ton of people. I hate the word entrepreneur. I hate that word. Mm-hmm. Entrepreneur. When I hear the word entrepreneur, it's a dude who reads all the entrepreneur books and has never actually run a business.
Yeah.
And you get the same thing here. You get these guys that they just want the information, but like, this is an actionable item. If you don't, but we'll, tomorrow, you know, we did the first day today, and we'll do a wrap up tomorrow as well. But I'll give you actionable items. Like, this is where you go tomorrow. This is what you're gonna do. Like, I don't want to just leave you with all this information. Like, here's actually what.
So
you
like do. For this course, this is a basic course, like we said. But day one, you're learning
the strength.
Yep. And the exercises for that, which are the squat, the deadlift, the press, and the bench.
Correct. Those are the four main lifts we teach on the first day.
Right.
Second day, there's a lot of content. We go over the other stuff. So we go over mobility. How important is it to be mobile? Conditioning, how to condition, which again is important for those of us.
And what's your definition of conditioning?
It's being ready for the fight, to be honest. It's being ready for the thing that we need to prepare for. So it might be if you were to say, hey, I want to run a half marathon. Being conditioned is being conditioned for a half marathon.
But diet would come into that.
Of course, and we go to nutrition. So we do. So on the second day, we do mobility. We do injuries. How to work around injuries. I got knee problems. I got back problems. I got fibromyalgia. I got osteoarthritis. I've got tendonitis. I've got all these, whatever. How do we work around those? Right. So those are not excuses to not train. Those are how do we train around those things? Right. How do we make those better? How do we rehab? We go through nutrition. Very simple, basic nutrition. Here's how you eat to perform better. And with performance is going to come aesthetics, right? We do programming. Here's how I put it all together. Like, I've taught me how to do these lifts. You've taught me how to do the accessories. You've taught me how to do conditioning. What do I do on Monday? What do I do on Tuesday? What do I do on Wednesday? So, yeah, we'll do all that kind of stuff. So we do lay all those things out. And we do.
But then you've got courses that people can, they want to get more advanced into.
Of course. Far more in depth. And then it's not, we do well. I'm not more throwing a huge plug out there, but
So
we do online. I mean, here's one of the problems. Everybody that's listened to this knows that the standard personal trainer kid at the Globo Gym at a Planet Fitness, the 18-year-old kid with the purple polo that's got the name tag that says trainer on, doesn't have a clue what he's doing. He has no clue what he's doing. 99% more of the trainers on the planet have no clue what they're doing. And so most of you that are listening to this do not have a good coach in your town. You cannot call the local gym and you say, like, don't listen to this and call the local gym and hire the trainer. They have no clue what they're doing. Yeah. They will steer you wrong.
Especially you New Year's people.
Oh yeah.
is that a hit over there?
As Mud Girl calls them, yeah.
Yeah, it's incredible. So I've been doing this since the late 90s, but I do it full time now. So I run an online coaching business called startingstrengthonlinecoaching.com. So if you go to startingstrengthonlinecoaching.com and Google us or whatever, we're easy to find. I am a starting strength certified coach. I'm also a certified strength and conditioning coach, CSCS. I got a USA track and field, all the kind of top certifications. But of all of the certifications in strength and conditioning,
just Google
Matt Reynolds. Starting strength is the by far, far and away, the toughest certification to get in strength and conditioning. We have, it costs $1,000 or around $900 to get the certification. We have a under 5% pass rate. So 95% plus people pay $1,000 to go to a long weekend seminar. They have to actually coach on a platform. You have to show us that you can coach the squat, the deadlift, the bench press, the press, the power clean, do all these sorts of things that you're learning this weekend. And then you'll fail, right? 96% of the people fail. Of the 5% that pass the platform on the weekend, so they actually have to pass a practical, like they actually have to do it. It's not a multiple choice test. If you pass the practical, you are sent an essay test that's going to be around 30,000 words, which
this
is
no joke.
You have 2 weeks to complete a 30,000 word test.
Hey Matt, is there anybody at this table that maybe scored the highest score ever on that? Is anybody sitting here that's that guy?
Sitting here?
somebody on the podcast got the highest score in the history of the test. That's actually not true. I got a 99. There have been 200 since then.
Wow.
I still to this day don't know what 1%. Mark Ribitaux said when he graded my test that it was the best test he ever graded. This is what happens when intelligence and experience intersect. That's a quote from Mark Ribitaux.
Nice.
And so I took the test, did well. That was in January 2010. 2 weeks later, Mark Ribitaux called me and said, "Can you be on a plane to Seattle?" Another quick background story. I come from a poor Southern Baptist South Memphis, Tennessee preacher's family, right? Like I was raised with nothing. As a matter of fact, I was 23 or 24 before I left the time zone. I'd never been out of the central time zone.
Wow.
And so since that time, because I know how to coach, because I'm a good coach, I've been to New York 5 or 6 times. I've been to Seattle 5 or 6 times. I've been to Toronto. I've been to Seoul, Korea. I've been to Mexico City. I've been to every city in America. I've been able to see the world. And so it's been an incredible honor. You know, I've got to pick up. I've learned so much stuff from these people. But back to the online coaching.
Right.
There are 120 starting strength coaches in the world. There have been thousands and thousands of people that have tried to get the certification, and only 120 have it. 30 of the 120 work for my company, and so 30, and I handpicked the 30. Mm-hmm. They're the best of the best. And so so if you don't have a good coach in your town. And you probably don't, but if you want to check, you can go to startingstrength.org, and you can search to see if one of those coaches are in your town. If they're not,
so if they're in your town, you get like personal.
You should go get coaching from these people, and you could do it on it 3 times a week, or you could just go get coaching from them once a month.
What's the online coaching part of it?
Can you
go into that?
Level? So if you don't have one of those coaches in your town, if you live in a town that doesn't have a great coach, you can go on and you can hire us. It's a little under $200 a month. It's expensive, but to put things into perspective, if you never hired a personal trainers run somewhere in the $400 to $800 a month. I mean, it's expensive. It's a Lexus payment to a house payment to hire a personal trainer. So for far less than that, for 25% of that, you can hire an online coach, a phenomenal online coach. And what this looks like is you'll fill out a pretty in-depth questionnaire about your goals, your background, your past, your injuries, your history, what kind of equipment you have to work with, what you're going to try to accomplish the next 3 months, what you want to accomplish the next year, your demographic information, where you live. And then what I do is I personally, myself, I read through that questionnaire and I pair you with a coach that I think will work very, very well for you. Somebody that may, you know, kind of specify with your demographic. Or maybe somebody that lives 200 miles from you that you can't see very often, but you might go to be able to see 3 times a year, 4 times a year.
Sure.
And so I'll hook you up with them. They'll start to coach you. What they'll do is they'll put you through a test workout. We send you all the instructions. Here's how you perform a squat. Here's how you can perform a deadlift. Here's how you do the basic lifts. Work up to a moderate weight, nothing too heavy. Mm-hmm. Video the lift. We teach you how to video the lift, where to put the video, where to put your camera. All you need is a smartphone. How to upload it to YouTube. How to send it to your coach. And then your coach breaks down that video and starts to write programming for you. The programming is sent over on an app on your smartphone, so every day you get up and you've got a workout, you know, 3 times a week or whatever, on an app on your smartphone. You take your smartphone into the gym, we all have our phones with us, into your gym or into your garage gym or wherever you train, and while you train, you can see your workout. So maybe your workout says you're going to squat 155 pounds for 3 sets of 5. You do that, and you actually say, like, that's what I did. I did 155 for 3 sets of 5, and you make little notes. You know, the third set was harder than I thought it was supposed to be. But I got through it. It was fine. You know. you make the notes there, and then you submit that, and while you do the lifts, you video yourself doing the lifts. So you video yourself squatting, you video yourself deadlifting, you send it to your coach, and within 24 hours, your coach will respond to you so that before the next workout, you have already received coaching from your coach. And when I say coaching, I mean actual detailed form breakdown. This is what I saw about your squats. Your knees got forward on rep 3. You're going to hurt your knees. You do that. You got to sit.
Is there any live interaction?
Like, so, yeah, absolutely. Like, so we do live stuff too. So we do Skype calls with our clients. So cool. We'll do one-on-one Skype calls or FaceTime. We've got a hand at Google Hangouts. We use that stuff as well. So, man, there's an enormous. We do nutrition. Really, it's kind of everything. So it's a blast, man. It works incredibly well. I've been doing that full-time since January of 16. And we launched with the 30 coaches that I have December of this past year, and it's just blown up. So we end up with 3 to 5 clients a day right now, new clients a day, and I cap every coach at 20 clients per coach. So I don't have any coaches that are overextended. I don't have any coaches that have 60 or 70 clients that can't keep track with everybody. So our big thing is not just quality of service, but it's the best quality service you can get. But it's also quality, the best quality coaching on the planet. It's the best technology. It's extremely simple. I mean, it's very low.
That's something that I truly appreciated. And James brought that up earlier. He said that he was looking for basically a 2-day easy to teach course. And he said the original course was just, it was like a scientific course. It's like a master's degree course. Yep. And, we've done like TCCC medicine. Now, TCCC for the military is a tactical combat casualty care. And it's a huge program. I mean, it's snake bites and field sanitation and all that. But you and I, if we're just driving around the street and we're going to the mall, we don't need field sanitation and stuff. We need this. We don't need this.
Yeah, we need this right here.
We need something that's digestible. Sure. And immediate action medical or beyond the Band-Aid. It took this big, huge thing and made it, okay, this is what we can use.
Sure.
And that's what impressed me about today's class and about the first day was the simplicity of it all.
Yep.
And I think a lot of people become overwhelmed.
Sure.
They look at it and they're like, I really need to. And then they start doing research.
Yep.
And they find all these programs and they're like, ah,
where do I start?
There's so much.
Sure.
And something that a question that Jared's gotten specifically is people say, okay, I'm down with you. I know that I'm soft.
Sure.
And I realize it, and I need to not be soft anymore. But where should I start and what's important?
Sure.
And when you talked about that today, so, well, should I run more? Should I bicycle more? Should I, what should I do?
Sure.
If I'm gonna commit to an area, where should I start and then move from there?
Sure. Yeah, so I'm a big believer that strength is the most important of physical attributes. And so there's reasons for that. It's not just on my opinion. And I love strength. I mean, I want to be clear. Like, I'm biased. I like being strong.
Do you like being strong?
Yeah, I love it. It's just fun to be strong.
It's crazy.
So it's a. But here's the deal. We tearing know
phone books and stuff.
This. Yeah. Tearing phone books is fun.
Did you do any of that in the strongman competition? Okay,
there is a YouTube video that somebody found on my forum of me tearing a phone book for a junior high class 10 years ago.
I can dare Camden phone book.
It's on. If you search Matt Reynolds phone book, Terrence.
It wasn't a Camden phone book.
No, it's a big phone book.
Oh, okay. It was a real phone book.
Have you done the frying pan bend yet?
Yeah, I've done that kind of stuff. That's not too hard if you're good. I'll tell you what's hard is tearing a deck of cards. I can't tear a deck of cards.
You can't get the leverage, or it's too small?
Yeah, it's just my hands aren't real big, and man, it's so small.
Can somebody tear a deck of cards?
Yeah, you've never seen the Power Team guys tearing. Uh-huh. Yeah,
the Power Team guys are crazy. They're off the hook.
Yeah so the you can think about it. There are a lot of physical attributes you could have. Mm-hmm. You could be conditioned. You could great endurance. You could have mobility. You could be powerful. You could have speed. You could have agility, or you could have strength. I mean, there's all these things. And the reality is that strength is the only one of those that makes all the other ones better.
Better.
Right? Yeah. So if I take, you take a kind of standard person that comes to the gym or comes to the class that is never trained before, never done the lifts before, is totally detrained, they haven't exercised in a long time, how is their mobility? Well, it's not very good. Like they would struggle in a yoga class.
Yeah.
And what I'm going to do is I'm going to teach them how to do the main lifts with full range of motion. So they're going to squat, but they're going to squat below parallel. And that's going to be difficult the first several reps, but we're going to get them there by the end of the day, and they're going to squat all the way down below parallel with the crease of their hip goes below the top of their knee. And what is amazing is on that first day, they will get stronger, but they will also get more mobile.
Right.
But this isn't a two-way street. They could also have gone, they could have gone to yoga class. If they go to yoga class, they get more mobile, but they don't get more strong. And so for me, that's why strength is the king of all physical attributes, because strength makes all of these things better. We in class, we literally go through all of those things. And we say, this is how strength makes this one better.
Right.
Strength makes endurance better, and here's how. Strength makes agility better, and here's how. Strength makes power better, and here's how. Like, if you've got a vertical jump, and you want to increase your vertical jump, and I teach you how to jump correctly, and you've got all the perfect form, and that might increase your vertical jump 2 inches, and then what?
I don't think anybody here is working on their vertical jump.
Yeah, probably not.
Not a whole lot of vertical.
Not yet. So.
A bunch of vertical jump. What I'd like to do now is get some of the students that were in class today and just kind of get some feedback from everybody. Who wants to
students? Let's fight strong class.
Wait, hold on. Can we do a Q&A session for him before he gets off?
Sure, that's fine.
Yeah, okay. Well, no, he's going to stay here.
Oh, you mean stay?
Yeah, you're staying here with the students.
Okay, so you guys that are live on Facebook right now, we're going to do a Q&A session with Matt at the end, so hold your questions.
Yeah.
Hold your horses.
At the end of this, we're going to do Q&A with Matt.
Q&A with me.
We can do a panel with me and Matt.
And I'm actually, I don't know if you guys know this, but I'm actually a professional in two different genres.
What's your other genre?
Bourbon.
Berman.
I've actually been interviewed by two podcasts. I've done two podcasts for whiskey and a couple hundred for fitness. So I'm catching up on the bourbon. But listen, I can do bourbon questions too. Any American whiskey, really any whiskey, scotch, I'm pretty good
with. Well, that's something that we've got coming up on a little spinoff that I'm going to be doing.
Yeah.
We'll talk about that
off
air.
Sounds good.
Definitely.
Oh, Paul, so XS didn't send you a bottle of bourbon?
No.
You got left out.
Zach Kinsley at excesssites.com.
And I'll add that he's very responsive, so if he doesn't respond to you,
so we need testimonials.
I think I know someone then. I'm pretty sure I know someone then.
Come up, introduce yourself.
Yeah, get up, Curtis.
Real quick before I go, somebody else takes my spot, I wanted to add that, as we mentioned earlier, I've been lifting for a while. And one of the things I've been sort of slacking on this year was my deadlifts. And I worked in it was like an intergym competition where we did the three lifts, squat, deadlift, and bench for a prize thing. I did it. It was like called a 1,000-pound club or whatever.
Sure.
It was kind of lame. But anyway, in that, I made it, but I only did 325 on deadlift, right?
Okay.
I hadn't really done a whole lot since then, as far as that. I've done a little bit, but I hadn't taken it very seriously. Going through the Fighting Strong program today, I was able to put 40 pounds on that.
Yeah.
On that max, that one rep max.
And it wasn't a max.
And
today.
405, right?
And I doubled it.
Yeah.
Today.
Yeah.
So this is just a testament to.
Yeah.
You doubled 405?
365, right?
365.
365. Oh, I thought 810.
No, you did 405.
No, I didn't. I didn't attempt
to. Oh, just Jared. Jared did for him.
Yeah, now Jared on the other.
Jared never done a deadlift in his life,
which was absolutely ridiculous.
Comes in, crushes 405.
I was chalking up for my 365, and I watched the bar, the 365 bar go up out of the peripheral vision. I was like,
what
the hell just happened? Like, it just jumped off the floor.
Yeah,
and it was.
He could have kept going up.
Yeah, he
we were running out of time.
Yeah, we definitely ran out of time. But anyway, I'll let somebody else take this over. So whoever is game.
While he's switching out microphone, I'll just so I can just embarrass everybody really quick.
Yeah,
because
we like that.
I don't know if she's watching or not, but so my wife, you can see her on my Instagram stuff too, SS Online Coaching. So she just deadlifted 402. She's a 40-year-old soccer mom who's had 2 C sections.
Nice.
And she's smoking hot. And so we're not talking about. She's not a big girl, and she deadlifts over 400 pounds. She squats. She squatted 347. By the way, this is at a powerlifting meet. Like at an actual meet with actual judges who have to judge depth,
wow.
Not like a gym bro lift. So yeah, she's got a 220 bench press. My wife does. 220 is pretty strong for a chick.
That's great. Yep. Yeah.
She's got a 347 squat and a 402 deadlift. And I'm telling you right now, like Jaeger and the guys that know her, she's the most feminine.
Yeah, she's a
girl.
She
looks like a Barbie doll.
Really?
There's nothing about her that's like masculine or bulky or. And
she did this all through the Matt Reynolds.
Yeah, I mean, this is the thing. She's not even really into it. This is the deal.
She's not really into it.
Does she like what you do?
That makes it.
She just
like, rubbing it in.
I sold the gym, you know, a little over a year ago, and I built a home gym. The problem is when you own the biggest gym in town and then you sell it, where do you go train?
Right.
What are you going to go train at one of the other gyms? And everybody's going to be
you
like,
better give Donald Numbers a shout out. You better give Donald Numbers a shout out on that gym.
So I was actually here exactly a year ago today. I was here at Tactical Response Teacher Fight Strong. And 2 hours before I left for Camden, Tennessee, Rogue Fitness.com, I spent $300,000 there in the last 5 years. They should give me a sponsorship. They sent me.
There was the
belt,
right?
Grief. So. They, I had received about 4 pallets of a home gym. I spent, I don't know, $10,000 with them, and I got a home gym. And I was telling Jaeger, I was really excited that I had this home gym to build. I had just come out of this. I'd sold my gym, and I was, you know, it was great. It was financial success there, but I was destroyed because I'd sold my baby.
Oh yeah.
And I was telling Jaeger, I was like, man, I'm excited to go home, but I got 4 pallets of gym to put together. And Jaeger said, "Oh, we'll just take your crew down and we'll help you put your gym." And this is the kind of guy Jaeger is. No, that's not why I asked. Come on, that's no. He said, "No, we're coming." And so he and Donald Numbers and Nate came down. Don literally built my gym in a period of about 6 hours, and we ruined about 10 saw blades trying to cut rubber horse mats to lay down. But so I've got a great gym. But it's one of those deals where honestly, for real, this is. Training has been something that has dramatically improved my marriage because it's something that my wife and I do. So, you know, I've got 2 little girls, they're 11 and 6, and they watch, turn on Netflix for them, whatever, and it's time for us to train, and we lift. My wife's not super into it. We could have done anything. I mean, we could have played sand volleyball or golf or something. She would have done it just because it's what I was doing.
Right.
And she got into it, so she got into training just because it's what I did, and she's not really that into it, but she does it because we get to spend quality time together 3 or 4 times a week. We get to train. And so she's just been consistent training. And so here's a 40-year-old soccer mom, 2 C-sections.
Deadlifting over 400 pounds.
Deadlifting over 400 pounds. Not bulky, very feminine, very curvy, very totally normal, beautiful girl. And so, and my best friend, it's made our marriage better, being able to train together. So it's pretty cool.
Family that trains together stays together.
That's right.
Right?
Yeah, it's cool.
All right, introduce yourself. Tell everybody
what's up, everybody? I'm a functional gentleman. I am a...
Is that the name your mom gave you? Functional gentleman?
Gentleman
is your middle name?
This is my social media persona.
Oh, okay.
I got to be all gray man and stuff. I don't want to cause a ruckus for my real life. So, what do you want to say?
All right.
So,
what have you taken away from the class so far? What's a nugget you're going
to
take home with you?
This is what happens.
So much.
Pass the microphone.
Yeah.
I'll start with the reason why I'm talking.
The reason
that I want to take this class is I've taken a bunch of classes, Tech Response, all of the classes from ShipWorks, South Narc, classes with John McPhee, Paul Sharp, Will Petty, all these people, and shooting is getting kind of boring to me. So I started taking jiu-jitsu, Brazilian jiu-jitsu, and I like the physical aspect of it, but I wanted to be stronger because, you know, when I'm choking people, their heads don't actually pop off, they just go unconscious. And I was like, man, it'd be awesome if I could just, shoot their heads off, man. It's great. So,
Mortal Kombat style.
And plus, when I roll with some of the bigger dudes, like, fatter, not stronger, like, you know, they can beat me, and so I was like, man, I need to get stronger, I need to do something about that. And I was talking to Jaeger about that, and I realized that, I think Matt was talking about it, in my martial path to being a warrior, whatever you want to call it, my physical abilities was my weakest link. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to kind of, you know, raise it up a little bit. And I lifted before with a bunch of bodybuilders in high school and college, and, you know, I was up there like, I was at like two, my, I think at my highest I was 220, low body fat percentage, but I probably wasn't very capable of doing much other than looking halfway nice. So I wanted to be, I know you hate this word, Matt, I wanted to be more functional in my life. I wanted my strength to benefit my life. And so I was talking to Jaeger about it, and he was like, oh, you should take
fight
control.
Be more capable.
Yeah, there you go.
There we go.
I'm not a wordiologist, I'm just a biologist, so that's what I'm doing. Don't expect gold from me. So I just wanted to, you know, get stronger, essentially, and I didn't want to go back to lifting weights like I had been and injuring myself. All my bodybuilding friends are they have terrible injuries. They claim they can't lift and all this other stuff. So the last time I was in an actual gym lifting weights was over 10 years ago, and I jacked up my back real bad. I think I either pulled or tore a muscle in my lower back, and I was just, ever since then, I just kind of let it go.
Because you're doing it in proper form.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I'm in the gym with a bunch of knuckle-dragging morons. Like, Matt might look like that, but he's actually really smart, so...
So of the exercises, which one are you going to really cling to?
All of them. Yeah.
All
there
of
we
them?
Go.
Yeah. Okay, well, all of them. Very good.
But yeah.
And then, of course, we're going to learn more about nutrition and everything
yep,
tomorrow. We yeah. have more questions about that today. But.
Sure.
All right, very good. Who's next? Who's oh, well, give tell everybody where your YouTube channel and everything is.
Functional gentleman. No, it sucks. You probably don't
know.
Functional
no.
gentleman.
Functional gentleman.
It's a functional gentleman.
Just, that's it?
I thought it was Jihad Lover 420.
I feel bad that I made the word functional.
Functional. Because functional.
I like the 420 in there.
And he wears school pants, so you know all that.
Yeah. Right
here. No, functional is fine. It's just a...
Yeah. No.
Functional is a buzzword in the yeah. fitness industry. That's the only problem.
Not only do I wear cool pants, 5'11 is extremely pissed at me. I think I'm on my sixth.
Well, I don't worry about it.
Yeah. I don't think they're going to break. Come on. Next. Look,
who's next?
My boy Brandon Miller. Coming up.
Brandon.
There he is, Brandon.
Hey, guys.
This isn't your first rodeo, right,
Brandon? No, I took this class in April of last year, and I did that because James had this contest, Biggest Winner 2016 or whatever, and I was doing great all year, and then I got hurt, so Matt offered to help me, and so I'm back for my second time taking this class, and I can't thank him enough for all the stuff he does, especially teaching us, you know, how to not hurt ourselves and how to get better and how to... you know, get stronger and live longer. Because yeah. at the beginning of last year, my doctor told me if I didn't change something, I was going to die.
You're going to die anyway.
Yeah. I'm a big, giant, fat guy, if the people on the live stream can't see. And so I'm working hard to get in better shape. And so from some inspiration from James and Matt, I built my own home gym, and I'm working with his online coaching program, and I'm here for a second time. And so it's amazing. I mean, it's everything you could ever want from a program. And so if you're serious about getting in better shape, getting stronger, fitter, harder to kill, then you harder definitely to kill, need maybe. to listen to Matt and take some classes.
You were crushing it today. I mean, you could tell that you had some experience with this before, because, I mean, your form just right off. I mean, you're nailing it, man.
Yeah.
It wasn't always like that.
It's improved a lot since you took it a few months ago, for sure.
Yeah.
So yeah, I mean, it's
you're building a home gym too, right?
Yeah,
he's got a great home gym.
I got with Rogue. Their customer service is amazing. They built a quote for me, helped me out, and so my UPS guy probably hates me because they delivered like 1,000 pounds of stuff to my house. But it's awesome, and his programming, his online coaching. If you don't live somewhere like he was talking about earlier with a starting strength coach, like I do, I live in a small town, and so. Every 3 days is how I get programmed. I have a coach that tells me what to do, how to do it, and then he perfect. Reviews my videos and then
so
tells me how to
do it. So you're using the online program.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
That's perfect, man. Mm-hmm. And how long have you been doing that?
Since October.
Since October.
I got hurt last year, and that's why I didn't win the Biggest Winner. But even though I told James
you should have broken your fork hand.
Yeah, yeah. but
nobody ever breaks the fork hand. It always can't work out.
So Matt offered to help me rehab. I had some stuff going on, and then I liked it so much, I started being a client. So.
That's
pretty cool. Good to have him.
And you got a website or anything like that? You're a preacher too, right?
Yeah, I preach at a little small church, and they're the reason I'm here. They are covering me tomorrow, so thanks, guys. You guys are awesome.
All right, next.
Oh, wait, shout out.
Aaron, get up
coach
here.
Bill Hannon.
Yeah.
Bill Hannon, great coach that works with Brandon Miller on a day-to-day basis.
And where is he located in the United States?
He's just outside of Indianapolis, actually.
Okay.
So, yeah, it's kind of one of
those
things.
Very effective, man.
Yeah, it is awesome. Great dude.
What's up? This is Aaron Hollins.
What's up, Aaron?
I own a company called Exit Strategy Bracelets. I sell escape and evasion stuff.
And escape and evasion. Give it a little more detail about that.
Well, for me, I like
to... Is that like Shawshank Redemption?
Shawshank Redemption.
Well, kind I guess of? It could be. What I like to really get myself involved in is kidnappings, home invasions, stuff like that. How to escape stuff like that.
Right.
So
you
like show
to get
some
yourself
your,
involved
well,
in kidnappings and home invasions.
Yeah. I was
he
going
likes
with
to
it.
Help people
I
get out of those it. Situations.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
right,
I think
right,
that's
right.
what he's trying to say.
This is a little small point
but he's
of clarification.
He's got these bracelets
yep.
that have hidden handcuff keys, and there's some kind of what? Talk about the saw that's in there.
Okay, so you have a handcuff key because criminals didn't used to use handcuffs very often, but it's getting more and more common. And if you're in handcuffs, there's really nothing else going to get you out of them.
Right.
There's a titanium saw blade and shim that you can use to cut out of stuff and shim out of zip cuffs, handcuffs. And the paracord itself that it's made out of will friction burn through tape, rope, string,
right,
zip ties, any, pretty much anything.
And then you got that other cool little chapstick
thing it's
that
basically
you designed as well.
For anybody who doesn't want to wear a bracelet, it's the equivalent to the bracelet. It'll has all the same components that'll do the same shit.
Very cool. And how can they get in touch with you?
ExitStrategyBracelets.com. Exit Strategy Bracelets on Facebook, Instagram.
Very cool. And you got all kinds of other cool stuff on there too, like the undetectable knives and
a bunch of polymer and carbon.
What was that
pin
thing?
It's a carbon fiber ventilator.
Yeah, that's kind of cool.
It's basically a big carbon fiber hypodermic needle that you can stab the shit out of somebody.
Yeah.
if that was something you wanted to do.
If that's something you really wanted to do. But
we didn't stab anybody in class today.
So, real quick, your background, your experience with working out.
I don't have a whole lot of experience with weights. I did a lot of body weight stuff for a couple years, and James always told me that it wasn't really working out if it wasn't under metal.
Yeah. What was cool about you today is that you were strapped the whole time when you were working out.
I'm not taking my... Unless we're doing force on force, I'm not taking my gun off.
Yeah. So, and how'd that feel doing all the exercise and everything?
It was perfectly
fun.
I took my backup gun that's appendix off because I knew that probably wasn't.
Now, when you put a weight belt on, you're going to have to wear your gun on your weight belt.
That'd be cool.
I'll get with Dave White.
I was going to say, tech to NSR.
Yeah.
Can you guys make a clip for my holster for my weight belt?
My weight belt, yeah.
Let's be some big loops.
Yeah, you can start training the gym, yeah. I don't know if the gyms would allow it. But.
Jay, the nightmare was the first one I had that deadlifted with a gun. It's the first guy I think I've ever coached that deadlifted while wearing a firearm.
A sidearm?
Yep.
What do you have?
He's at least the second because I was the first one.
Yeah, did you wear it while deadlifting?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay. I remember there's been times that I've coached you that you set it right next to you, I remember.
Yeah, but when we were at the first time we were doing cleans, I was wearing a pistol.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah. Yeah, you're warm. Yeah, you're warm too.
So what's your nugget that you're taking away from this?
I'm a lot stronger than I thought I was, and I need to be hitting the weights more. Because I would always slack off and not feel like doing it because I didn't think I could lift as much weight as I wanted to, so I just wouldn't do it at all, I guess. And so I found out I'm a lot stronger than I think I am, and I need to just stick with it.
Something that you're going to implement into your regime now. Very cool.
And eat more.
And eat more.
Just eat more. Just gain about 40 pounds.
Who's up?
You know, we talk a little bit about feelings when you train, the difference between training and exercise.
Does anybody else want to come up?
Jared?
Ryan?
We'll get Jared last.
Calvin?
Okay, we'll get Jared
Calvin,
last.
Calvin, get ready.
Calvin.
Can I talk about the difference between training and exercise? You know, exercise...
You have to speak.
Exercise values feelings.
Allegedly.
You know, exercise is about the way you feel today. It's about getting hot and sweaty. Jesus. Exercise is about going out. You know, exercise is about the people that get up and jog 5 miles every day, and so they feel better. They go to the gym and check it off a list.
You gotta put them on.
And so one of the most important things I think that we teach is that training doesn't care about your feelings. Like it says fuck your feelings. We don't care. And we're gonna train because it's training. And so if exercise
training has a goal.
Training's got a goal, man. We look at it. We look like, what are we trying to do out here? Today is one step in what we're trying to get out there.
Yeah.
And exercise is about the way I feel today. And let
exercise
me just,
is killing time.
Yeah, I mean, look, man, exercise is better than not doing anything.
Yeah, an extra 30 minutes, we're going to hit the treadmill.
That's exactly right. Yeah. Right? And is that better than doing nothing? Yeah, of course it is. And exercise, a lot of time, leads people eventually into training. So I don't want to, like, really talk about how exercise sucks. It's fine.
It's an integral part of it, of training. Yeah.
Exercise is people that are going to the range to just do target practice. That's exercise. And it's not the same thing as training, right? We're not training to fight. We're not training to be ready for a fight when we just go try to hit the center of the bullseye. It's not the same thing.
Right.
And really, fitness is the same thing, right? So we can get on a treadmill, we can run, we can get hot and sweaty, we can go to CrossFit, we can do random stuff all the time. But until we actually have a goal, until we have a program to get to that goal, that's when we train. And when you decide to train, it doesn't really matter how you feel. It doesn't matter if you don't feel very good. It doesn't matter if something kind of hurts. It doesn't matter if you're achy. And we kind of went through some of that stuff today, and we'll go through more tomorrow about like when is it okay to actually not train. And you'll be surprised at how few things actually occur that makes it not okay to train. Right. If you're running fever, you know, you got the flu, you can't train.
Stay out of the gym.
Yeah, but there's a, I mean, there's not very many things, you know, like you injure, you break your wrist. Can you train? Yes.
Sure.
Can you bench press? Probably not. Can you squat? Yes. Right? I mean, I saw, you know, I've seen lots of guys. I've seen guys that tore biceps and figured out how to deadlift. I watched a guy that deadlifted, tore a bicep, and deadlifted. He built a strap out of a seat belt.
Where there's a will.
And attached it to the barbell on his left side where he tore his bicep, wrapped it around his neck and held it with his right hand.
That's and, dedication.
I mean, that's because he said, look, what am I going to do? I'm going to sit around and do nothing.
Right.
So, that's the difference between people who train and people who exercise.
Calvin.
Sir.
Oh, wait. Step up to the mic.
Yeah,
hello. Introduce yourself to the lead heads and to the student of the guns.
Hey, guys. I'm Calvin. I work here at Tactical. As Mr. Matt says, I'm the last guy on the cadre who is.
Yeah. And by listening to his voice, what did you think? He's like a Southern Georgian kind of guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Big white dude.
Yeah.
Got a big dip in his mouth.
Calvin, you know, Calvin. <Very nice. laughs>
He in fact
is Asian.
He's an Asian dude.
I'm farther south and less east.
So the Facebook people can see what we're talking about. It's hilarious. But all right, so what did you gain from the class?
Oh man,
Have you done this course before, by the way?
No, I haven't.
That's your first time?
I took the abridged, I guess abridged version.
Yeah, sure. We did a tester with just the staff.
It was
a couple years ago.
Yeah, it's been
for just 4 or 5 hours.
Yeah, it was good. Thank you.
Sure.
Again, thanks, round two. The first time I was like, oh damn. All these things, like there's you know, form in the shit. So, you know, it's difficult.
Some thought goes into it, right?
Yeah, there's a lot of thinking, a lot of science behind it, as they say. It's not just bro science, right? I wasn't on a program way back. I've never been on programs. Like I just do stuff. I know.
You exercise.
Yeah, I exercise.
You just exercise.
I just exercise and do stuff, and then. But didn't realize I was also doing it wrong, just physically.
Sure.
Like, you know, and every now and then I tweak something, like my back. Never tweaked my knee in lifting heavy stuff.
You're lucky.
Right?
Yeah.
And then took that 4-hour seminar, and I was like, oh shit, you know, there's a method to the madness. I read Ripito's book a few years ago, because James recommended it. But then we were putting it all together, this is how it is in words, and this is how we're doing it.
Yeah. So it's all coming together from the class today, right?
It's all coming together, and this class really ties it in. It really, really ties it in, especially all the biomechanics stuff, what you need to do in order for you to do things properly and efficiently.
Right.
It's good stuff.
Now you're going to go get certified now, right?
What?
Yeah. $900, 5% pass rate.
Yeah, $900.
Matt needs an Asian in on his staff.
That's
so
true.
Come on.
That's true. Actually, we got a guy that just passed in Singapore.
Yeah, Drew.
Our first strength coach in Singapore. We got one in Seoul, Korea, and one in Singapore now.
Says two Asians checked on the list. Two tokens.
Yeah.
There you go.
How's your audience in Singapore? We got a lot of viewers.
I do have. Yeah. We're in 123 countries.
We've got a great coach in Seoul, Korea. Mr. Kim? Yep.
Not all surprised.
Of course.
Yeah. I'm trying to think of my guy in Singapore, and a dude in Singapore. His name's Sean.
Do you have a guy in Kazakhstan? That's what I want.
Kazakhstan.
Is there a guy in Kazakhstan?
I do believe there's one in Kazakhstan.
Oh, you've got a listener. We do not have a coach.
You have a listener in Kazakhstan?
Yeah.
He's the only one.
Listen, you know,
maybe he could be the coach.
True
story.
I don't know if he's still there.
True story. Borat showed up at Ripito's gym, and Ripito was supposed to be in that movie.
Really?
No way.
Yeah, Ripito kicked him out of his gym.
Are you serious?
Ripito didn't know what it was. They came in and said, you know, hey, we want to film. We get this guy from out of town. And, like, he just wants to get a training session. And he was wearing, like, you know, one of those unitard things. With the balls
the hot dog sling. The hot dog sling
the
unitard.
Everywhere, yeah.
That would have been awesome.
And Ripito didn't put up with shit.
Get out.
He came out and lost it. He didn't have, I mean, he had no idea. You know, they showed up movie set and all this stuff.
Huge.
And he's like, what the hell's going on? And he kicked him out of the gym.
Another one. Globo Gym.
Yeah. That was supposed to be at Rip Toe's gym.
Anybody else?
I want to see Kate. So we got Kayla's taking this class. She took it last time, so get a female perspective.
Yeah, absolutely.
So
step up, Kayla.
Jaeger's.
It's her favorite daughter.
Second favorite daughter.
I'm the favorite. It's not okay. On Facebook.
I don't see? Know. You put those not up? What he said. I don't know.
So we got a, so Jaeger's daughter took this last time, right?
I
so
did.
In September. So you want to walk through what that was like for you?
I went in just looking to get strong and
fit. Sure.
And the highlight of the class for me was deadlifting over 200 pounds. I did
look
205 pounds for
look
3.
Look at you go, girl.
I was pretty excited about that.
Congratulations. Yeah.
And I got a lot deeper in my squat. Building that booty.
So you started in September.
I did.
Right. Are
how
you
much
on the program?
Done, yeah, I mean, like, so one of the things I'm interested in is to talk about is how much had you done going into the class? I mean, you were a relative beginner.
Here we go. We got a new guest. New guest.
Got a superstar here.
Yeah.
I mean, how she smelled the bourbon.
That's what it was.
So, you know, what was that class like for a female coming into a class? We've had a bunch of females come through the class, but it's obviously a predominantly male class.
Right. I'd never really lifted before. Like,
sure.
I worked with Heather a little bit before the class, but I felt very confident leaving, knowing that I wasn't going to hurt myself.
Sure.
And the weirdest thing for me was when I went back to Georgia and went to a CrossFit gym and started doing it and just got a bunch of funny looks.
Sure.
Because I wasn't, like, jerking stuff around.
Sure.
I was picking heavy stuff up.
Correctly.
Correctly, yeah.
And you had just had a baby. Pretty recently.
Yeah.
I had two babies back to back. I was pregnant for like 2 years.
Is that one of your babies that was right there?
Yeah, the one that was crying.
Yeah.
That's my daughter, Emmeline. She's
a little camera shy.
She's one. So she wasn't quite one in September when I took the class. So
she's
getting
adorable.
Back into that. And then I'm trying to get back on the program. I just started nursing school.
Yep.
And that's going to allow me to set another schedule to where I can get in the gym every day.
Sure.
Because it felt really good. Like, that was something that I enjoyed doing.
Sure.
And could continue doing forever.
Sure. You're probably fairly intimidated going into the class, right? Was it intimidating when you got there? I mean, what was it like as far as, I'm for real, I mean, you don't blow smoke up my butt. It's just one of those deals where it's like, okay.
She Jaeger's daughter. She wasn't scared.
Well, I mean, it's one of those things.
Yeah,
you're,
you
know,
scared.
But, yeah, I mean, but you know, you're a female taking a class with a bunch of dudes. It's like, and it's a fitness class. And like, what was that like? And then what is it? How did it feel, you know, on a kind of day-to-day or even like hour-by-hour basis for you? Going like, okay. I don't really know what to expect. Like, what's this going to look like for you? And then, what was it like?
I went into the class with an extremely open mind, and I don't know if it was just because we had such a great group.
Sure.
But it wasn't really that intimidating.
Sure.
Lifting heavy stuff in front of a bunch of people in general is intimidating. Like, oh no, I hope don't fart.
All right, the truth comes out. That threw my mind all
finally,
day today.
Finally, some transparency.
I was like, I hope I don't sharp my pants.
Like, especially being a chick, like, we don't do that. So.
Yeah, you could shart, we'd laugh. If she sharted, you'd be like, oh my God. The chick sharted.
Yeah.
Oh,
so
man.
That's what
terrible.
I wanted to avoid
and
that.
And we had Mexican for lunch, too.
Yeah. But it was great. And then I think because we did everything so well and everybody meshed and supported each other so well.
That's the show.
Like, the hardest part was going into a gym.
Sure.
Gym, not the shop gym.
Yeah,
where,
sure. It's less supportive.
Yeah. Having to ask somebody, like some random stranger, to spot me on my bench. I'm like, he's going to look at me like I'm a girl.
Right,
asking
sure.
him to spot me on my bench. Like, but I'm.
But you went in. You went into the gym with more confidence, didn't you?
No, I felt like I was going to throw up the first time I went into the gym.
Really?
It was a CrossFit gym on army base. So everybody in there was like super fit, and like the girls are in there wearing.
They have shirts on.
Booty shorts,
yeah,
sports bras.
Like, and I'm in there like
long socks, neon shoes.
Like, okay.
Did they throw the weights on the floor and yell at them?
No, but I didn't go into the weightlifting.
Oh yeah.
Because there was just, it was full of dudes. So
throwing weights on the floor and yelling at
them. I stayed in the main part. But, I mean, everybody was great about it.
Mm-hmm.
And I did have somebody compliment me on my form on my deadlift. So
nice.
That was
wow,
nice.
Very
yeah.
good. Did you do curls? He didn't do any curls.
He's not taught us how to do curls yet. We're not allowed to do curls yet.
I don't think anybody's allowed to do curls. So.
Not in CrossFit for sure. They never do curls.
Right.
But I went in a CrossFit gym not too long ago. At the end, I was like, I'm going to knock out some curls. And the owner walked over to me and said, "You're the first dude to ever do curls in this CrossFit gym." The curls aren't that cool. I'm not telling you to do curls. I was doing them at the end of my workout.
If you need to find a wife, though,
that's how you do it, man.
Get
a bro out.
You find it with these.
Get a bro out a little bit.
That's how I found mine.
Just if I am.
Yeah.
Curls and tanning beds.
After I started the program, I got up to over 100 on my bench press. I think I did 80 on my overhead press.
That's actually really strong. Triple digit bench press for a girl is solid.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And so in spite of the
you just started in September.
Yeah, and had a baby, you know, within a year. And so
started nursing school.
That's a big deal. Yeah. So
congratulations.
That's really good.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So your goal is, you've got a goal, right, that you're mm-hmm. that you're wanting to accomplish. What's your time frame on reaching your goal?
Just because I'm having to start over, since I was working two full-time jobs when we first got here, so I'm like resetting everything.
Mm-hmm.
It'll probably take me until the middle of the year to hit where I want to hit, because I want to get up to like a 300-pound squat and get back to
July 4th.
Yeah, because I was
America Day. We should do like a July 4th PR day in Camden. We'll come here for July 4th.
We should like just do a follow with everybody.
That'd be awesome.
Or a press release.
A huge PR.
Press release?
That'd be awesome.
Now what's PR for the audience?
Oh, I'm sorry. PR is not press release.
They think,
sorry.
You're going to do a press
PR
release?
PR is, in fact, what we call a personal record.
Personal record.
That's the thing that drives everything.
Public relations?
So the thing that drives everything we do in strength is the PR, the personal record. So we don't care what other people do. We celebrate personal records, which means if you bench press 500 pounds, we celebrate it like crazy. But if you bench press 85 pounds, and that's your personal record, we also celebrate it like crazy.
Like crazy, yeah.
We celebrate PR. So like we don't care how weak you are, how strong you are. You know, I've done this for almost 25 years. I've seen you cannot impress me with your strength, but... So I get excited for PRs.
Just don't even try.
Well,
does the celebration involve bourbon?
Usually, afterwards.
Nice.
So
I'm setting my goal at 85 first. And we're going to work it up.
You know, there's actually funny. The best Olympic weightlifter of all time, his name is Vasily Alexeyev.
Russian?
Surprisingly enough, Soviet, right?
Yeah.
Dude in the 70s. And he was paid $5,000 for every world record he set. So he was notorious for setting... 0.5 kilograms.
Smart dude.
Yeah, I mean, it's communist, man.
He's got to make his money when he can. One
of the only capitalists in that entire country. Right? He's like, look, I'm just going to... So the problem was, for Vasily, the guy probably could have set records that even today are... The guy set records that today are still phenomenal.
Was he the guy on the Wide, Wide World of Sports?
Yeah, that was the guy.
That was him.
Yeah,
I grew up watching that.
He had a big red wrestling suit. Yeah, in that day there were three dudes. American was Ken Patera, who became a WWF
Sounds
wrestler.
Familiar, yeah.
Kenny Patera, he's dead now. And Belgium had a guy. Goddamn, what is his name? Oh, he got three. There were three guys that strict pressed 500 pounds, over 500 pounds, 502, 505. I mean, think about that. You guys watched the press day. You think about how. Probably no one that's watching this right now has seen a 500-pound bench press. And I'm talking about a 500-pound...
Not in person. No.
I'm talking about a 500-pound clean and strict military press. Straight over your...
Crap. Yeah, that's
incredible.
Three men in the history of the world have done that. So,
and you're one of them.
I'm not one of those. My best press is 315, which is pretty solid, but you know, when I watch those guys, it makes me feel like pussy.
Yeah.
So, it is what it is.
You tore your pec, like...
I've torn both pecs. I've torn a lot of stuff. Don't tell that story.
Yeah, right. It's too painful to talk about.
We're
not going to talk about it.
So, yeah, I mean, it's one of those things too. Jaeger was talking about this morning at breakfast. Is that when people come to me, they are weak and unhealthy, and I get them strong and healthy, and then I sit down and we have a talk. I say, hey, what do you want to do?
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to get stronger and also slightly unhealthy? Because at some point you are strong enough. you actually can get to a level where you're strong enough, and that's totally cool. And if you say, you know what, I'm strong enough, I just want to maintain my strength, I want to train for being harder to kill, I want to get more conditioned, I want to lose some weight, I want to get leaner, that's totally fine. I'm not going to judge you at all. What will happen to a lot of people is they go, yeah, I really like being strong. And I think I'd like to get a little bit stronger. And I'm willing to actually sacrifice safety on someone. Like, I think everybody's logical enough to understand that, like, you can squat 400 pounds and be totally safe. But you can't squat 700 pounds and be safe. Mm-hmm. So, at the time that you squat 400 pounds, you and I, if you're my client, I'm going to sit down and we're going to have a talk and say, look, you're squatting 400 pounds, you're deadlifting 500 pounds, and every human male on earth, adult human male, can press 200 pounds, bench press 300 pounds, squat 400 pounds, deadlift 500 pounds. That is a goal that every human adult male can and should shoot for without using drugs, without, like, a normal human being can do that. If they train consistently, they can do that. And at that point, they can say, I'm really, really strong. And then you have to make a decision. You say, like, am I strong enough? Do I want to maintain that strength? And do I just want to keep getting in better shape? Do I want to lose some fat? Do I want to train other things? Do I want to, like, whatever? Do I want to do some mud runs? Do I want to do some Spartan races? Do I want to do that kind of stuff? And that's totally cool. But if you say, I want to keep getting stronger, then we actually push the pendulum back to slightly less healthy. Mm-hmm. Because now you start to risk injury at that point. So, right. You know, and that's okay. There's also another, like, no one would look at, like, NFL football players, the playoffs are going on right now, and would say for an NFL football player that's healthy. It's not. Is it safe? No, it's not safe. But those guys are making $15, $20 million a year. So we say, like, that's okay. There's an incentive there. Yeah, right?
They've
so
got a payoff for doing that.
Safety could be theoretically
right. Real quick, though. The girls, like, they worry about looking like they done steroids and stuff. Like,
sure.
That almost, like, gyps people of the dedication they put into it.
Sure.
Like, you are not going to go into the gym and look like the women that you see in the fitness
class. That's exactly right. Sure.
And if you start getting bulkier than you want, like, you can hop off the train at any time.
You're not going to wake up one day and be a 260-pound linebacker.
Like, oh, no, I have muscle. Right.
So, you know, there's two things there. So when I get females that say, like, and we hear that, I mean, I literally hear
that's
every day.
That's an excuse.
Yeah.
Female says, excuse. I don't want to get too bulky.
Well, but a lot of them actually believe that it's going to happen. They don't, like, realize the dedication and strict.
They think if they lift a weight, they're just going to get...
Right. They're going to get man-body tomorrow morning.
So the first thing you can do, one of the best things you can do...
I think that's their excuse not to do it.
It is, but I mean, I think some of them actually think it. So I've taken women to a university gym, a bunch of college dudes, who are all trying to get bulky.
Right.
And you say, look at these guys. They're all 155 pounds. They're trying to get bulky. Not working. It's not working. And believe it or not, they actually have more testosterone in their system than you do. Than the female does. Mm-hmm. And they have the ability hormonally to get bulky, and you do not, right? So when a woman gets bulky, there's only two options. There's two ways that a woman can get bulky. One, she started fat, like significantly fat. Mm-hmm. You didn't realize that, you didn't know her when she weighed 280. And now she weighs 230, and she's bulky. But she looks a hell of a lot better than she did at 280.
Sure.
But you see her at 230, and you didn't know her at 280, and you go, man, she's bulky. She lifts weights. And she is bulky, but she started at 280
mm-hmm.
or two. She used steroids.
Right.
And the reality is that the vast majority of girls you see on TV, and all of them in bodybuilding, 100% of the girls in bodybuilding use steroids. Most of the women in figure and CrossFit, like on TV,
mm-hmm.
are using performance-enhancing drugs. And so they see those girls who say, I don't use performance-enhancing drugs. But they do. And they go, well, she told me she didn't use performance-enhancing drugs, and she's bulky, and I don't want to look like her, she's too muscular. She used performance-enhancing drugs. And so, for girls, it is nearly impossible for a female to become bulky because a female doesn't have testosterone in her system.
Mm-hmm.
And so what happens, amazingly enough, is that when a girl who especially has done very lightweight, high reps, 15 reps, 20 reps, aerobics, yoga, cardio, and stops doing those things and starts strength training, starts doing things like sets of five and sets of three that are heavy, is that her body responds the way she always wanted it to respond to the other stuff.
Mm-hmm.
She gets not bulky, she gets toned, which, like, the scientific word for that is actually tonus, which actually means that the muscles harden. They actually become more dense, not bigger,
mm-hmm.
dense, which means that like there's very thin skin on top of very hard muscle. It's very dense, and that's all they have the ability to do from a hormonal perspective. And outside of the fact that they're taking exogenous, which means hormones outside the system, they're not able to get any bigger than that. Outside of the fact that they weighed 300 pounds when they started,
right?
Which is fairly rare.
Let's get into some of the panel. The Jaeger League.
Q's and A's.
Let's do the Matt and James went upstairs.
Grandbabies.
All right.
The grandbabies are here. They went upstairs.
We'll do the Matt and Paul panel.
That's fine.
Jared,
get over here.
Yeah, I'm coming.
Jared.
To the rescue.
What do we got?
I'm glad you came over.
Yeah.
But before we do, Jared, let's hear your take on today.
Oh.
Because you were, like, just showing everybody up today.
I think Jared won the strongest lifter of the day.
He did.
Yeah, it was strong. Actually, this is important. I think this is an important conversation to have.
Okay.
Yeah, okay.
Thanks for being on.
We were talking about
Thanks for sharing.
Yeah.
So Jared is...
I don't know how these things work. I've never...
How do these things
work? I don't know what to do with my hands.
Jared's the producer, not the star.
Is that what he wears headphones.
Yeah, he knows how they go.
Yeah.
He's it.
I'm Jared Markle. I'm the producer and digital mastermind.
Also
actually,
known
I just got a
as
promotion. I'm the COO of Student of the Gun.
Little fedora.
Yeah,
MMA.
Not like a hat. like the fighter, Lil Fedor.
Fedor. Yeah. I say it wrong. Fedor.
Do you need Fedor to shorten it, Alex? Because he's like... Or did it go?
No, she's probably going to moderate.
I say we hit 20% battery. I'm just
so
going to go
real quick. Let's have this conversation before we get into it.
All right, we got 20% battery strength.
Yep. Strongest man of the day.
Yeah, I mean, so I think we have to...
I think Matt is that.
Well, I didn't lift today, but... So there's an important point that needs to be made that I think that you're going to ask this question tomorrow. I saw this coming. Which is... First off, why don't you tell us how you've trained or how you've exercised or what have you done physically going into today?
Physically going into today, I've done no heavy strength training.
Okay.
I've done kettlebells. I've done some type of martial arts since I was 5 years old.
Yep.
So it's basically been, I don't want to say functional fitness, but that's what people are going to know.
Yeah, I understand.
I mean, so that type of thing, kettlebells, sparring, body weight exercises,
circuit training,
yeah, high intensity
burnout
training
stuff, yeah, conditioning stuff, right?
And never lifted heavy,
which is fine. And so the reality is that you were out of a class of what, 15 or 16, you're the strongest guy there, right? So the most.
Did we go pound for pound on that?
Well, I mean, not pound for pound, right?
Okay.
So you're right. So
just kidding. Go ahead.
The question is, I'm going to ask for you is, are you strong? That's a weird question to ask, right? Because we have to have a standard for what is strong, right? And so you're around a bunch of mostly guys who the strongest guys there today squatted somewhere like in the low 200s, right? And you squatted a little heavier than that. And they deadlifted in the low to mid 300s and you deadlifted 405, right?
With ease.
And with ease, right?
Could have gone higher.
And the question is that strong, right? And so, I mean, I don't know. Like,
that's what I was going to ask.
Yeah, it's a great...
I have no clue.
It is certainly relative. So relative to the class, it's strong.
Relative to your size and weight.
Right.
Right.
Relative to my 40-year-old wife, it's not that strong.
Age.
Yeah. Which is an important... I mean, it's important. And I'm not saying that to embarrass you. The reality is that you actually could probably continue to train like you are... And could say, I'm strong enough to handle anything that life generally throws at me, and I'll be fine. And if you asked me that, and I was totally honest, I would say, yep, you're probably just fine. But you're not ever going to be any stronger than you are right now, right? You could maintain a strength level of a mid 200 squat and a low 400s deadlift to mid 400s deadlift, which is decently strong. Training like you are, but you could also get phenomenally stronger training less, and that's a decision you're going to have to make, right? So if you were at a table right now with, instead of three podcast hosts, and you were with four professional powerlifters, you'd be like, I'm not very strong.
Yeah, I'd be the weakest man at the table.
Yeah, and, you know, I get it. So so that's a question that everybody has to ask. I don't have that. I actually don't have the answer. I mean, the answer is, like, when do you think you're strong enough? I can give you really, you know.
Personal
goal. Yeah, we talked earlier. I mean, I think that a really good goal that's just an extremely, like, blanketed, bigoted sort of goal is a 200-pound press, 300-pound bench press, 400-pound squat, 500-pound deadlift. Any adult male can do that, right? By the way, Mark Rento says adult males weigh over 200 pounds.
Adult males?
Yes. Yeah, if you weigh under 200 pounds,
I'm an adult male.
You are, in fact, not an adult male.
I must be an infant.
You are a pre-pubescent male.
James, so,
thanks for it.
Are you finished with your...
No, I think it's an important point to be made. So, you know, I think
it's a good point. Yeah.
For people who are watching or listening to this thing who are not interested in, not into the fitness world at all, they would probably go like, that's pretty damn strong. And you're right. Compared to the average dude, you are pretty strong. Like, I don't want to come across and be like, I'm not impressed with your strength. Based on the type of work you've done, I am very impressed with the level of strength you have. And so a point needs to be made that any amount of training you do, even non-strength training, makes you stronger for a time. But there's a law of diminishing returns.
Right, you have that diminishing return.
That's exactly right. Yeah, so, like, if you've done nothing and you decide, like, I don't know how to lose weight, I want to lose weight, and you start riding your bike every day, and you ride your bike a couple miles every day, in a month, your legs are actually stronger. Mm-hmm. And so if you ride your bike for this, you know, for another couple miles for the second month, are your legs stronger? Not any more stronger than they were on day 30.
Yeah.
A great example to use is tanning. If you decide like, hey, I'm going to go on vacation this summer, I'm going to tan 15 minutes a day. So for the whole month of February, you tan 15 minutes a day. At the end of February, you're significantly tanner than you were on February 1st. Mm-hmm. And in the entire month of March, you said, I'm going to keep tanning 15 minutes a day so I can get more tan. How much more tan are you at the last day of March than you were on the last day of February? None.
Did you because your body,
right? Yeah, of course. Okay, Tim Ferriss. Was that in Tim Ferriss's book?
Something like that.
Yeah, he just quoted that on the show last week.
I'm pretty
sure.
Yeah, actually, that wasn't.
First off, let's be clear that Ferriss stole that from me. I didn't say that. Ferriss. Asshole's been stealing stuff from me for years.
No, you said diminishing returns, and you said
no.
You said 15 minutes on the show. You said any more than 15 minutes.
That's the minimum effective dose.
Yeah, which is also. I mean, I think minimum effective dose is an important thing to talk about as well, right? So we want to do a minimum effective dose, but we also want to continue to make progress.
Sure.
And so if I do 15 minutes a day of tanning, which is maybe a minimum effective dose for, say, the month of February, mm-hmm. I'm going to be tanner in the month of March. But if I do 15 minutes of tanning a day in March, I'm not going to be any tanner than I was at the end of February because mm-hmm. my body has already adapted to 15 minutes of tanning a day. So if you're training right now with a kind of standard high-intensity conditioning, burnout sets of squats at 135, you know, things like that, like, you have developed a level of base strength that will stay for all eternity as long as you continue to do that. But the question is, can you get stronger that way? Yeah. And the answer is probably no.
To a certain extent.
Right? Like, you get stronger that way till the point that he's at right now.
Yeah.
Like, and then you
until you can't.
You plateau.
It looks to me like that style of training for you is going to peak you out at about a 250 squat and a 425, 435 deadlift. Which may be strong enough for you. You might be able to go like, hey, I'm okay with that.
I'm putting 450 on you, brother.
Yeah, you probably could do somewhere in that ballpark. So the question is, like, how are you going to squat 350 and deadlift 500?
Yeah, exactly. I will tell you this, that actually I have two thoughts. The first thought is that I had a coach in Ohio. His name's John Saylor. And did he develop the conjugate method, or was that Louis
Simmons? Simmons.
Yes.
Louis Simmons was his rabbi.
He taught me the conjugate method of training.
That's great.
So I've been doing that, but I haven't been adding strength training specifically into it. Now, if I would have, and I've done several professional martial art fights, I believe that if I would have put strength training, the four core lifts, into my regimen, mm-hmm. then I would have won the last probably two fights.
Sure.
Yeah. Oh, Jared, speaking of, Quentin Henry's in the house.
Right. Judges.
Yeah, Quentin. If you're watching.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. Yeah, it's so for those of you guys that hear conjugate training, that's Louis Simmons is the godfather of powerlifting. He's Louis, probably 65 or 66 now, lives in Columbus, Ohio, which is kind of the hotbed of powerlifting. He was the first guy to read translated Soviet materials post fall of the Soviet Union, early 90s. The Soviets were phenomenally ahead of us in sport. We talked about this a little bit today, that communism, while a unbelievably horrible government system,
is a good motivator for strength training.
It's an incredible motivator for athletes. Right? It's a incredible motivator when there is no wealth, that if you don't hit the deadlift today, that your family's out on the street.
Kill your brother.
We murder someone. And so it makes good athletes. So they developed the conjugate system, which is, for, you know, it sounds like a crazy word. I'll make it real simple. Their system, that what they did is they worked all aspects of fitness at the same time. That's what they did. That's what Louis' version of the conjugate system is called. So basically, he trained for strength, he trained for speed, he trained for conditioning, he trained for mobility, he trained for power, he trained all those things at the same time. And I actually do think that can be done, but I only think that can be done by an intermediate lifter, by someone who's kind of in the middle somewhere, right? So if you think about, like, in the grand scheme of things, like, if a novice is only going to train for strength, and if strength training alone makes you better at everything,
right?
You can get to a point where strength training alone doesn't make you better for everything, and you actually train for everything to get better at everything, and eventually you get to the point where you're kind of like 70% good at everything, and then you have to choose. What am I going to specialize in? Am I going to be a marathon runner? Am I going to be a power lifter? And you're not going to get any better until you specialize. So really what you've done is you've kind of gone like, I'm going to kind of train for everything, and you probably are in pretty good shape. You could probably go out and run a mile in a decent time. You're decently strong. And that's not a bad place to be. That's actually like a phenomenal foundation of a place to be. So you're actually in a good spot right now where you could go like, hey, do I want to just get strong?
Now he can specialize in what direction he wants to go.
Or do I want to go do, you know, Spartan races? Do I just want to, like, you could actually choose right now, like, what is the fitness ability that you want to gain?
See, makes sense, because he's been doing professional MMA for like 6 years now.
Sure.
So MMA is mixed martial arts.
Sure.
So you have to be able to, it's like you said, 70% good at everything. You have to be able to grapple. You have to be able to strike. You have to be able to do throws. You know, you have to, and, you know, submissions and all that. So, you know, where a boxer can just box.
Better.
But
right?
it makes sense that you would do that.
The easiest way to do that is to look at, if you look at professional MMA fighter, or what were your rounds, 3 minutes or 5 minutes?
Five.
Yeah, so you got 5 minute rounds, three max?
Yes.
Okay, so you got 5 minute rounds, three max, right? So let's say there's no way to know that we've got this exact person. So we have somebody that is exactly the same level of skill as you have in mixed martial arts. The stronger guy wins every time. Like, if the guy is stronger, he can actually be, you know, for those of you guys that have been in, like, watched mixed martial arts for 20 years, you remember, like, Tank Abbott?
Yeah,
right?
Tank Abbott was a monster.
Ronda Rousey guy.
Yeah, we're not going to talk about Ronda Rousey. We're talking about Tank Abbott.
Think about Tank Abbott in the early years.
I was just like, this
Tank
is more
Abbott
recent.
is just a super strong bar brawler.
Yeah.
That's what he was. He won a lot of fights just because he was strong. Not because he had any skill in fighting. You know?
No.
As a matter of fact, the guy had the least amount of skill maybe in the history of the UFC. The guy had
Kimbo Slice.
Okay, yeah. He's another one, right? So yeah, the same sort of deal. Like, here's a mammoth dude who is insanely strong. So strength a lot of times makes up for bad technique, and I don't think it's an excuse for bad technique. What's amazing is that when you have strength and good technique, right? Like, I want to be the dude that has got a pretty good technique but is way stronger than everybody else, because it makes up for that. If you look at the Americans, where we were at our height in Olympic weightlifting, like in the actual Olympics, like the weightlifting that's in the Olympics in the late 60s, and our guys didn't have incredible form, but they did have incredible strength. I mean, in 72, they got rid of the press. They stopped doing they actually used to do the clean and press. They did the snatch, the clean and jerk, and the clean and press. And they got rid of the press, which the press was really the only lift of those three that were a strength exercise. Everything else was kind of a technique exercise. When they got rid of the press, we decided in America, specifically in the US, to focus solely on technique. And so if you go to, I've traveled to other countries doing seminars and stuff, and they say, oh man, the U.S. lifters, they've got the most pretty technique on earth. You know what we're ranked in Olympic weightlifting?
Low.
54th.
Yeah. Sometimes pretty doesn't win.
Pretty never
Sometimes
wins.
Sometimes you got to be ugly.
Exactly. Pretty never wins, right?
Speaking of ugly, we're running long here, so.
All right.
diminishing returns here.
You got two episodes worth, don't you?
This is the new year. So kicking off the new year, we're going to do a 2-hour show here. So let's do our Q&A.
Okay, let's do it. I'll go fast.
Student of the gun.
Right, rapid fire.
I'm going to get off here, so I'm going to go over to the phone.
You going to run the phones?
Yeah. So you guys start asking questions.
Okay. All questions.
Right. Are they still there? What time is it in Central Time?
It's 10.
I'm tired, so I'm
good. Yeah, it's been a long day.
So let's do about 10 minutes of this. Is that?
That's cool.
Got enough for 10 minutes?
Has it been?
I can rapid fire. Comments? Quick answers.
What do I do to make my penis bigger?
Okay. Is that the first
exercise for that?
The Swedish penis pump.
The Swedish smoking a pancake.
Oh, there is no pleasing you.
My pastor or my mom is not watching this.
Beneficial lifts. What are the two most beneficial lifts?
What are the two most beneficial? Squats and deadlifts. If you get only two, that's what you need. And it's not just because of the muscle involved. The muscle involved in the squat and deadlift are the greatest, but the hormonal response, we haven't even talked about that today, there's a hormonal response that occurs when you do a lift that hard. So you especially as a male, but even as a female, but as a male, your body produces more testosterone, more growth hormone out of those lifts.
So 40 plus people, they start lifting heavy things.
Yeah, you got to.
Or men, if you're listen, north of 40,
mm-hmm. you have to lift. Yeah, you guys that have low testosterone need to lift heavy.
Low T, baby.
John say? What's the difference between an 18-year-old man and a 40-year-old man? Testosterone.
Yeah, you're exactly right.
Mark Schofield says, did you have something over
there? Hey, Mark.
He says, strength training to help cardiovascular health. So maybe he's asking, strength training help?
Sure. All right, so let's go through two of those pieces. So
I was breathing hard.
If you've ever done a max effort set of five on squats, like if your max effort set of five is a 300-pound set of five on squats, you should do that with a heart monitor sometime. All right, go get a $40, $50 Polar heart monitor, put it on your chest, do your squats, and see what your heart rate goes. Because at the end of a five rep set of squats, of the max effort set of squats, your heart rate's going to be 180, 185. And it's hard to get
there. I didn't need a heart monitor to
know that it was high.
Does it work on a Fitbit?
Mine was pumping on the deadlift.
Yeah, I mean, if it works on a Fitbit.
Yeah, yeah, it actually
Fitbit
does.
Measures your heart rate. You
Jared does.
Yeah.
We should What's have measure
that, that's a so, yeah, that's yeah. a That's a great one. So, yeah, it's great. And then strength training will absolutely make it better. Now, will it make it incredible? No, like, it's going to get it to a point that it's an intermediate level of cardiovascular fitness. And then you're going to have to do cardiovascular stuff to get it there.
You're not saying don't do cardio.
No,
just do
of course
strength.
Not. Strength is the greatest of physical attributes, but it's not the only physical attribute. Right?
Next question is from Jason. He says, when is the next class?
April. Yeah, we usually do them in April and September. Yeah, April and September. By the time I leave here this weekend, the dates will be up for April and September. So it's somewhere in that ballpark. We usually do mid to late April and I think early. So it's usually the weekend after Labor Day.
And they go to tacticalresponse.com, and can they go to your site as well and get that?
Yeah, I usually have that stuff too, but you can go to Tactical Response, got the main stuff.
You talk to Marilyn if you want to slot.
Yep,
that's the answer.
I would recommend going with the online training until you can get to the live class. So go to starting strength onlinecoaching.com.
Yep, that's correct.
And sign up for the online coaching. I learned more in 2 hours today than I have in 27 years.
That's awesome.
35 years here. I get you beat on that.
Thank you.
All right. Josh Blanchard says, is it possible to train for strength and muscular endurance?
Yeah, of course. Again, that's an intermediate thing. When you're a novice, if you only train for strength, we define a novice as if you can add weight to the bar every single workout, you're a novice. So if you can squat 155 pounds for three sets of five on Monday, and you can go up to 160 or 165 on Wednesday, and go up to 170, 175 on Friday, you're a novice. And so as a novice, strength training alone will make you better at muscular endurance. I can make that real simple, right? So I bench press almost 500 pounds, not bragging, but if we all got in a push-up competition right now, who do you think wins?
Somebody else.
Probably not.
You don't think you? So? You think you could?
Yeah.
I think we should test that off.
I think I'm real close.
No, I agree
I'm
with him already.
I'm 280, 285, and I can promise you all, I can hold my own. I'm sure I can sit down and knock out 75 or 80 push-ups, and I'm 280 pounds, so 85. So the point is this, is that muscular endurance is still based on strength. Let me put it this way. The guy that bench presses 225 or the guy that bench presses 500, which one has the more muscular endurance? Who can do more push-ups? Probably the guy that bench presses 500 pounds. I mean, if he weighs 400 pounds, maybe not, right? But in general, that helps. Yeah. After you're a novice and you become kind of an intermediate lifter, then you have to start training for some muscular endurance, right? If you've got a sport that actually requires muscular endurance, then what I would do is I would do your strength training, and then I would do a drop set, a burnout type set, like what you do. So
drop
you
the
do
weight down.
Your squat set, and then you drop the weight down to 50% of that.
You go to fatigue.
And you do it for as many reps as you can. Just remember, that's going to cause an enormous amount of lactic acid buildup, a waste product, and it's going to take some time to recover from that.
Drink a lot of water.
Yeah, you're not going to be able to train 2 days later and go up.
So I just did biceps for the first time. Like, I did a targeted exercise of biceps for the first time about Tuesday of this week, and I was just healed before I got healed.
Yeah, you're pretty sore.
Yeah. So it sucked. But, okay, next question. This is actually a good question because you hit on something earlier. And I had shoulder surgery on my rotator cuff.
Yep.
And so Robert Rickey says, best exercise or exercises for rehab of a torn rotator cuff.
Yeah, that's a great question. I'm going to surprise you guys. The military press.
Really?
And everybody that's got a torn rotator cuff is going to go, I can't military press. Yes, you can.
Yes, you can.
Right. When you have a torn rotator, which, by the way, means you've torn one of the four rotator muscles, or your labrum, which is kind of like a rubber O-ring washer at the end of your humerus, at the end of your upper arm. When you've torn one of those, the only way to rehab it is make your shoulder stronger. If you don't do anything, your shoulder gets stronger. So if you military press correctly, which we just call the press, and I'll give you real quick cues. When you military press, those of you guys are watching, your elbows are going to be forward, not out. You can't chicken wing out. Your elbows are going to be forward. Your wrists are going to be straight. You're going to keep it in line with the middle of your foot. You're going to try to, if you've got whiskers, it's going to run through the whiskers of your chin. It's going to barely miss the tip of your nose.
When it says in line with the middle of your foot, that's the bar.
Yeah, the barbell, if you dropped a plumb line down from the barbell, it would be directly over the middle of your foot. And it's going to get pressed straight up in a straight line. At the top, you're going to shrug up, try to touch your ears with your shoulders. That's the best thing you can do for your rotator cuff. Bench press is by far worse for your rotator cuff than your press. And we're learning this today. You retract your shoulder blades on the bench press, and you keep them retracted. Mm-hmm. And so there is some amount of range of motion loss in your bench press, that all of that shoulder blade's not allowed to move through a full range of motion on the bench press, and it is allowed to move through a full range of motion on the press.
Right.
So if you have a torn rotator cuff, you need to get back to a full range of motion. You've got all that scar tissue in there, so you've got to work through it. So.
Okay, one more.
All right.
We got one more here. Sorry if I mentioned it earlier. What are your views on supplements?
Simple, right? Supplements, I think the three basic supplements you should have: whey protein, which shouldn't be considered a supplement. Whey protein is made from milk. Milk is made of whey protein and casein. Little Miss Muffet sat on her tuffet eating her
curds and whey,
right? Curds are casein. It's like cottage cheese. Whey is the liquid part of cottage cheese, or also the liquid part of yogurt. The stuff you see on the top, whey protein, and what they do is they take...
So was Little Miss Muffet a powerlifter?
She's jacked, man.
Little Miss Muffet. She was jacked.
Little Miss Jack Muffet. So, yeah.
She's just Jack Muffet.
Whey protein, for dollar, calorie for calorie, is the best protein you can eat. Whey protein, creatine, everybody should be on it. There have been millions of studies on creatine. Your mom should be on it. Your grandma should be on it. Your dog should be on creatine. There's no side effects for creatine.
Real quick on creatine, because I got a question on creatine, but I'll let you finish that.
No, you said one more.
This is mine. This is part of his. But when should you take creatine?
All the time. You should never load it. You should never get off. 5 milligrams a day, 1 teaspoon a day, every day, forever,
until
Jesus comes back. Take creatine.
Perfect.
And the last thing that you really need is branched chain amino acids, BCAAs. You don't even, that's an optional one. Like, the first two are absolute 100% 1 and 1A. And then branched chain amino acids are a thing, especially if you're dieting and subcaloric between meals, you take branched chain amino acids, which, long story short, amino acids, the leucine and amino acids are the things that make you start protein synthesis. It makes you start building muscle. And so you can actually take a little bit of this stuff. I get Extend from Skyvation, or Scivation, S-C-I-V-A-T-I-O-N. That's the brand that I get. There's lots of great flavors. You put it in a bottle of water, you shake it up, and you drink it between meals, and it keeps you from wasting muscle if you're dieting. It works great. Those are the only three I recommend. There's a, one or two others that aren't really that important, and that's it.
Okay.
Real food is awesome.
Very cool.
So,
all right. Very good. Matt, thank you so much for taking the time.
Thanks for having me, guys.
The class has been phenomenal.
Awesome.
Mind-blowing.
We still got another day. Tomorrow's more mind-blowing than today.
Yeah. Tomorrow's going to pull all this together, and he's going to show us how to implement it. So
awesome.
Thank you guys for setting this up. Thanks for doing the student
hey, thank you having for me. Having
Facebook
us.
Facebook Live.
Should I remind people what they need to do to hear more from Jared and I? And
absolutely. You
know, well, obviously, Marty has been on Student of the Gun, and we've been on Talking Lead.
You've been on Talking Lead when I've been on Student of the Gun.
Well, no, I'm just kidding. We've known each other for years,
yeah.
And but Student of the Gun, the first place to go, just go to studentofthegun.com. It'll lead you to the TV show or the radio show or whatever.
Get free online training courses.
Yeah, free online training courses, all that stuff. And then Matt's going to remind you where you need to go.
StartingStrengthOnlineCoaching.com. You can Google Matt Reynolds or StartingStrengthOnlineCoaching.com. Either one, show up. I'm easy to find. Social media.
What was that article you mentioned that everybody needs to read?
Barbell safety.
I wrote an article a few years ago about how to lift safely. So if you Google Matt Reynolds barbell safety, it'll teach you. If you're like, I'm all by myself, how do I do this? I don't have training partners. I don't have spotters. Barbell safety, Matt Reynolds. Google, it'll pop up.
There you go, guys. And of course, thanks to James,
Tactical Response, for hosting all of us.
Motherfucking CFO, Tactical Response.
That's right.
hosting this gig, really appreciate that. You guys check them out, tacticalresponse.com. Check out their training courses. They've got a lot to offer.
I think they have a YouTube channel.
He's got this little small YouTube channel. You know.
Who's James Yeager?
That's not how you know you made it, man, when you have a YouTube channel.
That's
how you know.
And then, of course, thanks to all the Talking Lead sponsors, Nordic Components, Cobalt Kinetics, Frontier Tactical, X-Tel Targets, Modern Spartan Systems, Glock, the official carry of Left Hand Talking Lead, and there's several others, and I'll get to those. But this
and
is
Mookie went to bed. He would Mookie, tell, he would
yeah,
tell
thanks
you
to
at
Mookie.
Night, but he got we talked
check him out. Spikes Tactical, they do an awesome job there, and Mookie does just phenomenal with everything that he does. So check him out. He's the Mookie Militia. What else does he have? He's got several things going on.
Spikes Tactical, Ben Mookie Thomas,
Ben
Mookie
Militia,
Kaka.
VSO Gun Channel, thanks to Curtis. Without him telling me about this class, I wouldn't be here. So
there you
greatly
go.
Appreciate that. So we will be back next week with a whole new show for the new year. And as always, lead heads, keep your loved ones close.
Keep your firearms
closer.
And keep your personal trainer even closer.
Keep your personal trainer even closer. In 3, 2, and keep your
personal.
In 3, 2, and keep your
personal
trainer
closer. Dear beginner ones.
Okay.
So I'm gonna play a commercial. I'm gonna play something for you guys up here on the camera.
You got a commercial?
Not a commercial. It's something cool.
It's something. I'm gonna play.
Holy. Good job, man.
Holy balls.
Thanks, guys.
Yeah, that went like an hour longer.
Every lifter needs a coach. Whether you're new to strength training or you've been doing the program for some time, working with an experienced coach can help you improve your technique, optimize your programming, and avoid many of the common mistakes and setbacks that result in stalled progress, frustration, injuries, and wasted time in the gym. In-person, real-time coaching from a certified starting strength coach is the most effective and efficient way to learn barbell-based strength training. But with only a handful of starting strength coaches in the world, getting in front of a competent coach is easy set and done. That's why we're all excited. Starting Strength Online Trees, a new service of advice that is in-person, real-time
coaching. What the hell is going on?
You got like 90 things running.
Yeah, I stopped there to get my.
As a starting strength online coaching client,
start that over for you guys. How about that?
up with a certified, or you've been doing the program. Every lifter needs a coach.
There you go.
Whether you're new to strength training or you've been doing the program for some time, working with an experienced coach can help you improve your technique, optimize your programming, and avoid many of the common mistakes and setbacks that result in stalled progress, frustration, injuries, and wasted time in the gym. In-person, real-time coaching from a certified starting strength coach is the most effective and efficient way to learn barbell-based strength training. But with only a handful of starting strength coaches in the world, getting in front of a competent coach is easier said than done. That's why we're excited to introduce Starting Strength Online Coaching, a new service that combines a network of expert certified starting strength coaches with a suite of powerful web-based collaboration tools to bring you the highest quality, most interactive online coaching experience in the industry. As a Starting Strength Online Coaching client, you'll team up with a certified starting strength coach who will oversee your training and deliver customized, regularly updated workout programming every week. And thanks to our partnership with FitBot, you can easily access your programming, track your progress, and communicate with your coach through a simple, user-friendly app. When you complete a workout, simply upload video of your lifts to your private training log and leave any important notes about your session. Within 24 hours, your coach will review your videos, critique your technique, and provide useful cues, corrections, and feedback for you to incorporate into your next training session. That's right, with Starting Strength Online Coaching, you'll have a certified starting strength coach evaluate every lift from every workout to keep your technique in check and help you avoid developing any bad habits. Additionally, you'll have access to our exclusive online forum where you can connect with our amazing community of coaches and clients, ask questions, discuss topics like programming and nutrition, and get the support and encouragement you need to succeed in the gym. While there's no substitute for in-person coaching, the unprecedented level of personal attention and interaction between our coaches and their clients makes Starting Strength Online Coaching the next best thing to having Uncle Rippy standing on a platform with you. So, whether you're starting out or stalling out, let our team of expert starting strength coaches help you make the most of your time under the bar. Starting Strength Online Coaching. Custom programming, rapid feedback, unparalleled service.
Yeah, when am I going to get that again?
I think Lauren's going to become the strongest street pimp we've ever had.
Yes, Lauren, she's our street pimp.
Yep.
This is a little bit behind the scenes for you guys. I don't think they know we're still recording.
No.
But that's the thing, people don't have to listen to it all at once. It's freaked up. That's what a lot of people do.
We did Friday show.
You're still live.
So we're still live?
Yeah.
What?
I just played a commercial for him. We're going to go now.
Turn off. I said swear.
What do you tell him?
Check us out, talkinglead.com.
What do you tell him?
Suck it.
you got to give him your sign out.
Student for life, baby.
What are they supposed to remember?
I'm going. I'm tired. I'm going to bed.
I'm Buck Henry, and I'm a student for life.